This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Atra-g-g-g. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Well, thank you so much, Fred Foy, and hello, everybody. Welcome to The Glowing Dial once again. I'm Big John Matthews, and over there, Steve Archiver Bannock, and we are going to bring you about 3 hours of old-time radio entertainment and frivolity on our part.
Oh, definitely frivolity, yeah. Uh-oh, I shouldn't have spoken until I was introduced. Oops.
That's okay. I said Steve Archiver Bannock, and then you talked.
Yes. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Put your, right. You're going to aim your mic down just a little bit there. There
is
we
that
go.
Better?
That's much better.
There we go. Okay.
Yeah. I gotta ride the level on Steve's mic because sometimes he gets excited and pins the meters. we gotta watch that.
I get excited over Amazon.com. That's one of our things at the end of the program that you always mention about Amazon.com.
We can mention that anytime in the program that we want to, actually.
Yes. Would it be such a, would it be as effective if it was called dominatrix.com? No?
It wouldn't be suitable for a family show. No.
But they can get away with it calling it Amazon. Huh? They're just thinking of the river, maybe, instead of
No, I'm thinking
woman.
Of Wonder Woman myself. She was the ultimate Amazon. Right there.
I just remember that from last show on the Amazon. I wonder what they're referring to on that. I went, oh, yeah.
And I am going on record as saying Linda Carter is the one and only Wonder Woman in my book.
Well, there's the new lady. Have you seen Gal Gadot?
I have, but Linda still wins my heart. And she is still a beautiful lady today.
Mm-hmm.
In her 60s and still lovely. Mm-hmm. Kind of like Stevie Nicks, who is pushing 70, but she's still gorgeous, too. Mm. Some women just retain the beauty just forever.
She might be 70, but she's still on the edge of 17.
Yeah, no wonder she has a wild heart. Mm. Anyway, to the show. We're celebrating Father's Day this time around, and we have some shows out of our grab bag as well. So a lot of good stuff, but right now, we're going to get to the first part of our celebrity birthdays.
Birthday list for The Glowing Dial, and we'll start off with June the 4th, 1901, Carlton E. Morse. He was a writer, producer, and director. He did One Man's Family and I Love a Mystery instead of a parade. Right.
That wasn't the theme to I Love a Mystery.
Right, that's right, yeah. June the 5th, 1910, gives us the famed character actor Herb Vigran. He was Sad Sack in the show of the same name, Sad Sack.
Mm-hmm.
He was Hector Smith on Father Knows Best. And he did many other radio and TV roles. He was in Brady Bunch, I know.
I just saw him in an Adam 12.
Oh, he was all over the place, definitely. Made his rounds. June 6th, 1918 brings us Peter Donald, born in Bristol, England. He was an actor and MC. He was Ajax Cassidy on the Fred Allen Show. And he also was the guess the star of Can You Top This?
Yeah, quiz show. He was involved in that show, yes.
Mm-hmm. June the 7th, 1913, gives us Tom Collins. Where have I heard that name before?
I don't know, Stephen.
Yeah, it's a mixed drink. That's right.
Have you heard of it, or have you drunk it?
No, I don't think I've drank it. I think I've heard of it.
He
was an actor. He was Shandu in Shandu the Magician. He was also Nicholas Lacey in One Man's Family. And wrapping up this segment of the birthday list, we have June the 8th in the year of 1910. We have John Campbell Jr., born in Newark, New Jersey. Oh, I've been there. And he was a writer and host. He did Beyond Tomorrow and Exploring Tomorrow. He just loved tomorrow.
He loved science fiction.
And that's a lot of tomorrow.
All right. But those are other tales of tomorrow. Yes. Moving on.
I haven't lost that appendage, tail. I'm still wild.
I think this might be a record, Steve. We're going to get into the first show in record time here.
Wow.
Yeah.
We're still having some fun. That's pretty good.
Yeah. We haven't talked about Aunt Millie's buns yet, but...
No.
With our own, growing to these chairs.
It's like Ronald McDonald. How can you tell when he's on a nude beach? He's the only one with the sesame seed buns.
Oh, my back is golden arching over that one. All right, anyway, that really bad joke. Anyway, that's all I had. Sorry, so sorry. And yes, I'm a sorry individual. We have an episode of The Lone Ranger, ladies and gentlemen, for you, boys and girls. It's called Two Boys and Their Dad. It's from Wednesday, January 16th, 1952, and that was originally over WXYZ Detroit and ABC. And Brace Beamer is playing the Lone Ranger. John Todd is Tonto. Our own Fred Foy is announcing. And the sponsor was General Mills, although the commercials are not heard here. We just hear music fill during the breaks, to which the local stations would pot that down and read their commercial script, pot it back up, and then the episode would start.
Ta-da!
Bum-ba-da-bum. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Steve is... sitting by over there was some voluminous information on the Lone Ranger, which I need to pare down sometime in the future.
The Lone Ranger is, I remember that program on television. When I was a youngster, they would have it on Saturday mornings, afternoon, whatever. The Lone Ranger first appeared in 1933 in a radio show conceived by WXYZ, Detroit radio station owner George W. Trendle and Franz Stryker, the show's writer. So it originated out of our hometown here, Detroit. The character was originally believed to be inspired by Texas Ranger Captain John R. Hughes, to whom the book The Lone Star Ranger by Zane Grey was dedicated in 1915. Hughes hunted down the gang who killed Texas Ranger Captain Frank Jones in an ambush. The radio series proved to be a hit and spawned a series of books, largely written by Stryker, an equally popular television show that ran from 1949 to 1957, comic books and movies. The title character was played on radio by George Seaton, Earl Grazer, and most memorably, Brace Beamer. To television viewers, Clayton Moore was the Lone Ranger. Although during a contract dispute, Moore was replaced for a time by John Hart, who wore a different style of mask. On the radio, Tonto was played by, among others, John Todd and Roland Parker, and in television series by Jay Silverheels, who was a Mohawk from the Six Nations Indian Reserve in Ontario, Canada. The Lone Ranger is so named because the character is the only survivor of a group of six Texas Rangers, rather than because he works alone, as he is usually accompanied by Tonto. While details differ, the basis of the story of the origin of the Lone Ranger is the same in most versions of the franchise. A posse of six members of the Texas Ranger Division pursuing a band of outlaws led by Bartholomew Butch Cavendish is betrayed by a civilian guide named Collins and ambushed in a canyon named Bryan's Gap. Later, an Indian named Tonto stumbles onto the scene and discovers one ranger is barely alive. In some versions, Tonto recognizes the lone survivor as the man who saved his life when they were children. According to the television series, when Tonto left the Reed place with a horse given him by the boy Reed, he gave Reed a ring and the name Kimo Sabe, which he said means trusty scout. He nurses the man back to health. Among the Rangers killed was the survivor's older brother, Daniel Reed, who was a captain in the Texas Rangers and the leader of the ambushed group. To conceal his identity and honor his fallen brother, Reed fashions a black domino mask from the material of his brother's vest, a vest upon which the Star of Justice had lain. To aid in the deception, Tonto digs a sixth grave and places at its head a cross bearing John's name so that Cavendish and his gang would believe that all of the Rangers had been killed. In many versions, Reed continues fighting for justice as the Lone Ranger even after the Cavendish gang is captured. The first episodes of The Lone Ranger premiered on radio January 30th, 1933 on WXYZ Radio in Detroit, Michigan. As previously mentioned, the show was an immediate success. Though it was aimed at children, adults made up at least half of the listening audience. It became so popular it was picked up by the Mutual Broadcasting System, and on May 2nd, 1942, that's 9 years later, by NBC's Blue Network, which is in time became ABC. The last new episode was broadcast September 3rd, 1954. Transcribed repeats of the 52-53 episodes continued to be aired on ABC until June 24th, 1955, and then selected repeats appeared on NBC's late afternoon weekday schedule from 5:30 to 5:55 p.m. Eastern from September 1955 to May 25, 1956. Original sponsors included Silver Cup Bread. Well, that's a local one. Get that in Detroit. Gingham Bread, Merita Bread, Bond Bread, a lot of bread ones, and General Mills for Cheerios.
All right. Thank you, Stephen. I think nothing remains but for us to tune this episode in for the good people. And we've gotten to our first episode in a record time here on the Glowing Dial. We usually have the running mouth, you know, and we go off in cosines and tangents.
Blah, 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 yeah.
Yep. They called Mr. Hayes Gabby, but they never met Steve and myself. So, all right, are you ready, sir?
All I do is talk, talk. Yeah, I'm ready. McGee Machine, do you read me? Lone Ranger, please.
Aha. All right, there we go. Folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember the Lone Ranger, two boys and their dad. From Wednesday, January 16th, 1952, over WXYZ Detroit and ABC.
A cloud of dust and a hearty hi-yo, Silver, the Lone Ranger.
Thank you.
faithful Indian companion Tonto, the daring and resourceful masked rider of the plains, led the fight for law and order in the early western United States. Nowhere in the pages of history can one find a greater champion of justice. Return with us now to those thrilling days of yesteryear. From out of the past come the thundering hoofbeats of the great horse, Silver. The Lone Ranger rides again.
Come on, Silver. Let go, big fellow. Are you Silver? Away!
Mrs. Manley, a neighbor from a nearby ranch, stood at the bedside of the Widow Jones and listened as the dying woman pleaded with her to take the widow's young son, Billy. After Mrs. Manley promised to take the boy for a short time, she reached out and patted the widow's hand, saying,
I promised to take Billy as you asked, Sarah, but I'm sure it isn't going to be necessary. You'll get well again and... Sarah? Doctor! Doctor, you'd better come in.
What is it, Mrs. Manley?
Well, the way she looks, Doctor, I think she's unconscious.
Ah. It's all over, Mrs. Manley. Widow Jones is dead.
Dead? Oh, poor Sarah.
Come, let us step into the next room. She asked to speak to you alone. Did she manage to tell you what was on her mind?
Yes, Doctor. Yes, she did. It was about her boy, Billy.
Poor lad. He's an orphan now.
I know. This will be a shock to him.
Are there any close relatives who might take the boy?
He has a grandmother in Dry Rock, south of here. But she always resented the marriage of her son to Sarah and has had very little to do with Billy or his mother since the boy's father died.
I see. But under the circumstances, I'm sure she'd be willing to take the boy. After all, he is her grandson.
Sarah told me Billy's grandmother is very mean-tempered. She felt that the boy would lead a very unhappy life with the old woman. That's why Sarah wanted me to take Billy for a while. At least long enough for him to get over the shock of her death.
Yeah, poor woman. Her only thought seems to have been for her son.
Yes. Yes, it was, Doctor. Sarah's whole life was wrapped up in that boy.
You have a boy, don't you, Mrs. Manley?
Yes. My boy Ted is about Billy's age. I'll keep my promise and take Billy a while. Perhaps having another boy around will soften the blow of losing his mother.
You must have been a good friend to the Widow Jones to make such a promise. I'm sure it's best for the boy right now.
Sarah and I were good friends, Doctor.
Have you known her long? Has she lived around here very long?
Sarah and her husband lived on this ranch until almost 12 years ago. Her husband died just before my son was born. I remember it so well because no doctor was available. Sarah practically saved my life. They stopped the stage out on the trail and brought in a doctor at the last minute. He was on his way to St. Louis.
I see.
I was seriously ill and I remembered little. But when he saw I was out of danger, he went on. Sarah nursed me until I was well again.
I noticed her boy when I came in.
Yes. Right after my boy Ted was born, Sarah left here. She said she was expecting a child. While she was away, her boy Billy was born. She came back here 2 years ago.
Yeah, too bad the father didn't live to see his son. Billy seems like a nice boy.
Yes. Yes, he is. I understand he and my boy were born a few months apart. Well, Doctor, I'll find the boy and take him home with me as I promised. I'll break the news to him as gently as I can.
It was 3 weeks later when the doctor decided to drop by the Manley Ranch and see how Billy Jones was getting along. He was in the large living room talking to Mrs. Manley.
How's Billy getting on, Mrs. Manley? I suppose with two boys, you have your hands full.
Yes, Doctor, I really do. Billy is a lovable boy, and he should make a good playmate for my Ted. But Ted seems to resent any attention that's given to Billy, and, well, they get into frequent fights. I'm afraid I'll have to send Billy to his grandmother before long.
Well, now, that's too bad. The Widow Jones dreaded having the boy go to live there, but I suppose he'll have to sooner or later.
You know, I'm awful hungry.
Well, Billy, how are you getting along here?
I'm not Billy. My name's Ted Manley, and I live here.
Yes, this is my own son, Doctor. Go into the kitchen, son, and get some milk.
All right, Mom. And I want some bread, too.
Funny. I could have sworn that was a Jones lad. Of course, I've seen him only a couple of times.
The boys do look somewhat alike. I've thought of that before. But naturally, I think my own boy is better looking.
Of course.
Where's Ted, Mother Manley?
He's in the kitchen getting something to eat.
I'm hungry, too.
All right, you go along and eat with Ted.
Yes, ma'am.
I think the resemblance is remarkable.
Hey, give me that. What? You took the biggest slice.
Oh. I did not.
Give it to me or I'll take it away from you.
You better not try it.
See what I mean, Doctor? I'd better go out and settle this before they start a real fight.
That evening, after the boys were sleeping, Mrs. Manley sat down to have a serious talk with her husband.
Buck, I'm afraid we're going to have to send Billy to his grandmother's sooner than we intended.
Oh, now, Mary, what's the hurry? From what I hear of that old curmudgeon, the poor boy'd have a heck of a time.
Buck, you're not around during the day. Billy and Ted go from one fight to another. They just don't agree on anything.
That sort of squabbling doesn't mean anything, Mary. It's good for him. I used to battle with my brother all the time. I'm sort of getting to like that Billy. Seems like my own boy at times.
Well, just the same,
now, look, Mary, Ted was born while I was away on a cattle drive. And if it hadn't been for Sarah, well, maybe you or Ted might not be here now. Let's keep him a while longer anyway.
All right. But it's mighty trying to hear them at each other's throat every 5 minutes.
I'm bringing a couple of ponies over from the Bar X spread tomorrow. Just borrowed them for the boys to ride. That ought to keep him quiet a while.
Oh, Buck, you're too soft-hearted, but I like you for it. The boys will get a surprise when they see those ponies. They'll get along better, perhaps, after the ponies arrive.
The following morning, the two boys stood beside Mrs. Manley on the ranch house porch. Their faces were aglow with excitement as they waited.
How long do we have to wait, Mom?
Now, Ted, don't be so impatient. Why can't you wait quietly like Billy does?
But it isn't his father who's bringing something to show us. So that's why Billy doesn't get tired of waiting.
Ted, don't say that.
But it's true. Daddy's my father.
He told me I could call him Dad sometimes if I wanted to.
But he isn't really.
Ted, stop at this instant or I'll send you inside.
But, Mom, why should Billy...
Quiet, Ted.
I wish he was my real dad. I never remember having them.
Well, both of you, close your eyes quick. Your father's coming with the surprise.
Hey, boys, look here.
Ponies!
Oh, are you going to let us ride them?
Sure. Come on down here.
Now, take it easy, boys. You'll scare them away.
I want this one.
Oh, hold on, Ted. You wait till we see
Jessica. Oh, it's all right, Dad Manley. Let Ted have that one. This one is nice, too.
All right, then. Yeah. Now, hit leather, both of you. Let's see how you ride them.
Steady, boy. I'll ride better than you, Billy. Dad showed me how to ride.
Steady, boy. Well, I didn't have anyone to show me how, but I can ride pretty well.
Now, be careful, both of you, and don't go very far.
All right, you cowpokes, hit the trail.
Come on there, get out.
Get up there, boy.
Get out. Come on. Come on.
Look at him go, would you?
They certainly are happy together right now.
Yep. Maybe we better keep Billy here all the time, Mary.
We'll wait a while before we make a serious decision like that, Buck. Come on in and have some coffee.
We better not go any farther, Ted. Maybe we ought to turn back now.
Oh, you're always worrying. Hey, look, there's a creek just ahead. Come on, get up, boy, get up.
Get up there, boy.
Whoa, there. Golly, that looks cool. Steady, steady. Let's go swimming.
We'd better not. Steady there, boy. We've come a long way from home, and anyway, there's a curtain there. It looks strong, too.
Guess you can't swim. That's why you won't go in. But I'm going in.
Well, I can swim, but I'm not going in.
Scared cat. I'm almost ready.
Well, I'll watch the ponies. They might leave us if we don't watch them. And you better not swim long either.
I'm going to get a running start and dive right in.
Hey, you better not dive in, Ted. You don't know what might...
Here I go.
Ted, where are you?
Billy, my head,
He must have hit his head on a rock. Ted, hold on. I'm coming. Ted! Hey, Ted!
Help, Billy! Help!
He's here down the street.
Billy.
I have to get him.
Billy,
just gotta.
Meantime, two horsemen leisurely followed the trail along the bank of the creek. They were the Lone Ranger and his Indian companion, Tonto.
We'll soon be at the mission, Tonto. Isn't much farther.
Ah. It'd be good to see Padre again, Kimasabi.
Yes. He'll be expecting us. I remember the last time we were...
Who's over? Who's gone over there?
Tonto, I heard someone calling.
Ah.
Help! Help!
That cry came from down the creek. Come on, Silver.
Get him up, Scout! Look, Kimasabi.
There's a boy clinging to a rock in midstream.
Ah, him holding someone else. Water deep there, current strong.
I know. Hold over, hold. Easy, Scotty.
Easy, Scotty.
If he loses his hold, they'll be dashed to pieces over the falls.
It's not good.
Here, take my guns. I'm going after them.
Me come too.
No, you move along the bank. Keep your lariat ready. I must get to them.
Help! Help! I'm slipping!
Hold on!
Although the Lone Ranger had entered the stream above the position of the boys in the water, he had to fight the strong current to keep from being carried past them. With long, powerful strokes, he gradually made his way until finally he reached out and grasped the rock Billy clung to.
I can't hold on.
You're holding another boy.
Yes, he's hurt. I can't let him drown.
I'll get you to shore somehow. And don't be frightened. I'll hold him. You grasp my shoulder.
Yes, sir. Here he is. He slipped away. He's gone under.
Cling to the rock, quick. I'll get him.
No, come back. You'll both be carried over the falls.
The curtain falls on the first act of our Lone Ranger adventure. Before the next exciting scenes, please permit us to pause for just a few moments. As the boy Billy tried to transfer the unconscious Ted to the Lone Ranger, Ted suddenly slipped away into the current, leaving Billy clinging to the rock in midstream. The Lone Ranger immediately dove after the other boy.
Come back! You both drowned!
I must find him.
The masked man dove underwater, and a moment later appeared on the surface holding Ted Manley. The current had carried them both downstream toward the falls, and it was too strong for him to hold Ted and swim back to the rock where Billy clung. The Lone Ranger, holding Ted's head above water, struck out for the shore. Then he heard Tonto call out,
"Kimasabi! The rope! Ted, rope!
Throw it, Tonto!"
The stalwart Indian stood a few seconds, gauging the distance, then threw the snaking rope, which landed within reach of his masked friend. The Lone Ranger grasped it and quickly looped it about Ted and himself. A few minutes later, with Tonto's help, he reached the bank with the boy.
Throw the lariat to the other boy, Tonto. Hurry before he slips from the rock.
Boy! Ted!
A few minutes more found Billy pulled to safety onto the bank, where he lay exhausted and gasping for breath. Tonto and the Lone Ranger turned their attention to giving first aid to the exhausted Billy and the unconscious boy, Ted.
You'll soon be all right, son. Tonto, how about the unconscious boy?
Him get cut on head. But me think it'd be all right with plenty good care, Kimasabi.
Ted, where's Ted? Don't let...
Easy. Easy, son. Ted's going to be all right. Don't worry.
The ponies. Our ponies.
We'll find your ponies. Now, you lie quiet and rest a while.
Kemosabe.
Yes.
This one, him breathe better now. But him need looking after.
I'll care for the boys while you go upstream and get the ponies. And we'll take them where they'll be properly cared for. The mission is close.
It good take him to mission. Padre see them get well. Me go get ponies. And me come back to mission.
The Lone Ranger and Tonto took the two boys to the mission where the Padre made them comfortable. The boys were put on cots in one of the bedrooms and were soon sleeping normally. After a couple of hours, the Padre and the Lone Ranger went in to observe the boys and found them awake.
Well, my son, how do you feel?
I feel all right now, sir. Where are we?
You're at the mission. This is the Padre.
Oh, Billy told me not to go into the water. I hit my head when I dove. Billy saved me.
That masked man saved both of us.
We'll have to get word to your people. What's your name, son?
I'm Ted Manley, sir.
Buck Manley's boy?
Yes, Padre.
You're fortunate, my son, to have such a brave boy as Billy for a brother.
Oh, he's not my brother.
Not your brother?
No, sir. He's Billy Jones. He's staying with us for a while since his mom died.
Oh, I understand.
But I wish we were brothers now. I wouldn't fight with him anymore. He saved me.
Well, I wish we were, too. Someday soon, they'll send me to Grandmother Jones, and I don't want to go. I wish I never had to go there.
Sometimes, son, our Creator moves in strange ways. Perhaps you'll not have to leave the ones you seem to love so much.
I'd better send Tonto to notify Mr. Manley that the boys are here and safe, Padre.
Yes, of course. But before you do that, amigo, I have something to tell you.
Yes?
Rest now, boys. We'll return later with food.
Padre, I was under the impression that those boys were brothers. There's such a strong resemblance.
My son, I have a story to tell you that may clear up a great deal of misunderstanding.
Yes?
About 12 years ago, a ranch hand from the Manley spread arrived at the mission asking for aid. I returned to the ranch with him to do what I could.
After hearing the Padre's story, the Lone Ranger decided to ride with Tonto to the Manley Ranch. It was dusk when they stopped before the ranch house.
You wait here, Tonto. Mr. Manley?
Yes, come in. Mask, what do you want?
I came about your son and the other boy. They were nearly drowned, but they're safe now.
Nearly drowned? Why, they were horseback riding. They weren't near the water. You're up to something. What is it?
You're wrong, Mr. Manley. Both boys are at the mission, recuperating from an accident in the water.
Hold on, now I see it. You picked up those boys and recognized one of them as my son. You came here to ask ransom before I can get him back.
The masked man suddenly took advantage of a lax moment on Manley's part and reached out, grasping the wrist of the rancher's gun arm.
All right, drop that gun. Drop it. Well, that's better. Now perhaps you'll listen while I explain about your son.
Buck, what's going on? I heard the... Oh, what's that masked man doing here?
I figured this outlaw's holding our boy and Billy, that's what. And he had the nerve to come here and ask for ransom money.
Oh,
wait. Please let me explain.
Briefly, the Lone Ranger told what had happened and concluded by saying...
Both boys are at the mission under the care of the Padre. They're both all right now.
Oh, those poor boys. We must go to them.
I'm not so sure this stranger's telling the truth. How do I know that he
is? You'll have to take my word for it right now.
All right, reach, mister. Quick.
Good work, man. He didn't see you come in the open door behind him.
What's wrong, boss?
Looks like we caught an outlaw.
Yeah, keep him covered.
Don't worry.
Mary, get the rest of the hands here. Have one of them ride for the sheriff.
But, Buck, what he told us about the boys and all may be true. We'd better listen
to... You drop guns.
Look, an Indian in the doorway. He's holding two guns on us.
Yeah, better drop the guns, boys.
Please. If they're shooting, someone will be killed. Buck, perhaps you're wrong about the masked man.
I explained why I came here, Mrs. Manley. There's no need for gunplay. You'll find the two boys at the mission, as I've already told you.
But that doesn't explain that mask, mister.
Kemosabe.
Yes?
Maybe it better you come now.
Yes, we'll leave.
Can we try to stop them, boss?
I wouldn't if I were you.
Easy, man. They have the upper hand right now.
They're not convinced I told the truth, Tonto. We'll have to move fast. Come on.
Easy, Scout. Easy, fella.
Come on, Silver.
Get him up, Scout.
Shoot.
Shortly after the Lone Ranger and Tonto galloped away from the Manly Ranch House, Buck Manly drove the buckboard around from the barn and stopped in front of the house to pick up his wife, Mary.
Oh, hold there, ho. Ready, Mary?
Yes, I'm ready.
I'll help you to the seat, ma'am.
Thank you. We must hurry, Buck. If the boys are at the mission, as the masked man said, they may be hurt.
As far as I'm concerned, that masked army was lying. But we'll go to the mission and make sure.
What if he was lying, boss, and the youngsters aren't at the mission?
By Jimmy, we'll trail him and the Indian till we find him. And if any harm has come to the boys, we'll gun those outlaws right in their tracks.
Whether you believe it or not, I think we'll find the boys as the masked man said we would. Now drive on or I'll take the reins myself.
All right, all right. See you later, Fred. Get up there. Get up!
It was later that night when Buck Manly and his wife Mary arrived at the mission and were met at the door by the Padre.
Padre, I'm Mrs. Manly and this is my husband. We were told that my son and another boy are here.
Your boys are here and safe.
What?
Come right in.
Well, then the masked hombre was telling the truth after all.
I feel so ashamed, Buck, the way we treated him.
My masked friend understands. He has a forgiving nature. Moreover, you owe him a great debt, my friends. You see, he saved both the boys from death in the rushing waters.
Oh, Buck.
Tarnation, take it. Why didn't he say so?
He tried to tell us, but you wouldn't listen.
No matter. Since there's no harm done.
The boys, Padre, where are they? We must...
Before you go in to see them, there's a story you must hear, my friends. And the one who should tell you is the man who saved them. My masked friend. I'll call him. Will you come in, my son?
Good evening, Mrs. Manly and Mr. Manly.
Say now, I guess there's things I ought to say.
Forget what happened at the ranch. I realize you were upset.
The Padre says you have something to tell us.
Yes, something very important, Mrs. Manly. You see, Billy saved Ted.
What?
He held him up until I could reach them.
Well, I'll be darned. Mary, we really ought to keep that boy all the time.
I think you will keep him. You see, Billy is really your own son.
What?
Hold on now. I'm mighty fond of Billy, but when you say that
he speaks the truth, my son, my friends.
Billy and Ted are twins.
Twins? But I...
Listen, please. When the boys were born, Mrs. Jones was your only attendant. The Padre made a short visit to the ranch. You were in a critical condition. Twins had been born. The doctor who was brought from the stage was known to the Padre. Today, he verified the fact that twin boys were born to you, Mrs. Manly.
But the doctor is somewhere in St. Louis. How could he...
After the Padre told me the story this afternoon, I used the new and quick method of telegraph. Well, this is the reply I picked up a short time ago.
Let's see... I recall the incident when I was asked to leave the stage and attend Mrs. Manly 12 years ago. Twin boys were born. I left before Mrs. Manly regained consciousness. Oh. A Mrs. Jones was in attendance, signed Dr. Norton.
Then Sarah Jones took one of my boys to raise as her own.
Yes. Evidently, the death of her husband a month before had affected her. She took Billy from you.
Then that's why she made me promise to keep Billy a while. She hoped we'd grow to love him and keep him.
I'm sure that is what she hoped.
Oh, my poor boy. To think that we
no
almost...
No wonder they look so much alike. We better get to see them, Mary.
They're waiting to see you. And you have the news to break to Billy.
Come, I'll take you to them. My sons, you have visitors for whom you've been waiting.
Mom, Dad, golly, I'm glad to see you.
What about you, Billy?
Well, I'm glad to see you, too. Awfully glad. But, well, you're not really my mom and dad, so...
Oh, but we are, son. We
what?
Are.
Huh?
We found you at last. But now we know that you're Ted's real brother and our son.
Honest? Are you sure?
Yes. Yes, darling. It's really true. You'll be ours always.
Golly, I have a brother.
Yep, he's your twin brother. He was lost a long time, but now he's...
Heaven
back.
Is due thanks for returning a lost lamb to the fold. Billy, my son, I'm sure there's great happiness in store for you from now on.
We'll sure be one happy family, Padre.
If that masked man hadn't saved us, I wouldn't have found out that you're my mom and dad.
Your bravery in saving your brother was rewarded.
Billy, my brave little son, we'll be so happy together.
And we'll never fight either.
I wonder...
That masked stranger, he He's done so much, and we owe him so much in the way of apologies and thanks. Padre, who is he?
He and Tonto have left quietly. He needs neither apologies nor thanks. Your newfound happiness is his reward. You see, my friends, he's the Lone Ranger.
This is a feature of the Lone Ranger Incorporated, created by George W. Trendle, produced by Trendle Campbell Enterprises, directed by Charles D. Livingston, and edited by Fran Stryker. The part of the Lone Ranger is played by Brace Beamer.
This is Fred Foy. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
Big John and Steve are back with you. It's The Glowing Dial, and we are celebrating Father's Day this time around. Hope you enjoyed our Lone Ranger episode in that theme called Two Boys and Their Dad. From Wednesday, January 16th, 1952, originally over WXYZ Detroit and ABC. We've got three more episodes here that we've pulled out of our old-time radio grab bag without the mousetrap.
Yes.
So Steve's finger is almost healed now. So, I don't know how that, I tell you again, I don't know how that got in there. It could have been back when we had the rodent trouble here in the house.
Yeah, it could be.
I didn't want them eating up all our OTR, so.
I believe you.
Put a trap in the bag there.
Please be careful. Uh-huh. Check everything out ahead of time.
All right. We have, like I said, three more shows coming out of our grab bag. But first, we have some more birthdays to share with you. And I'm going to take over here on those. June the 9th, 1910, Joseph Julian was born in St. Mary's, Pennsylvania. He was an actor. He was Sandy Matson on Lorenzo Jones and Archie Goodwin on The Adventures of Nero Wolfe. June the 10th, 1903, one of our favorite people, Mr. Ernest Chappell, the man who spoke to you, was born in Syracuse, New York. He was an announcer and actor, announcer on the fabulous Dr. Tweedy, and he was, of course, like I just said, the man who spoke to you on Quiet Please. He was also featured on Big Story.
I thought I saw a ponytail. That's Tweedy.
Spelled differently, sir. Okay.
Anyway. Oh, very well.
June 11th, 1911, Long John Nebel from Chicago, Illinois. He was the host of an all-night talk show in New York City over WOR. It was the granddaddy of all paranormal talk radio programs. He inspired Art Bell, George Noory, Jeff Rentz, and others. And he had his show at the height of the UFO freak, I guess you want to call it. People that say they flew to Venus and drank whiskey with the aliens and,
Yeah.
And there are some of those shows that survive. I think you can find them on YouTube. And if you can find the one with the mystic barber, and there's the same one, there was a lady who supposedly is channeling aliens, and I fell off my chair laughing. I really did. But Nebel took all these people seriously. He let them say their bit, and he tried to give them a bit of respect, you know. So check some of those out. If you're a fan of Art Bell and George Noory, Jeff Rentz, and things like that, check out Long John Nebel. June 12, 1914, Herbert C. Kenny. He was a singer, member of the Ink Spots, the Four Ink Spots, that is. And that was one of the shows that was featured, named after them. And also Let's Go Nightclubbing. June 13, 1892, Basil Rathbone, my favorite Sherlock Holmes of all time. Although I think Benedict Cumberbatch is doing a pretty good job as a modern-day Sherlock. Basil was born in Johannesburg, South Africa. Of course, they said he's famous for playing Sherlock Holmes, and he was also Inspector Burke on Scotland Yard's Inspector Burke.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that's it for this portion of birthdays. If you want more birthdays, if that ain't enough for you, our buddy Ron Sales has got you covered. He's got a blog with him for the whole year, including the leap day, February 29th. To get there, you just go to glowingdial.com, menu on the left, you click on links, and the link to Ron's page is right there. Drop him an email and let him know what a good job he's doing, and tell him Big John and Steve from the Glowing Dial sent you on over there.
You don't get there by following Yellow Brick Road, no? No?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, okay.
Actually, I don't think there is a real Yellow Brick Road made of gold.
Hmm.
Didn't Elton John sing
about that in a song, too, about the Yellow Brick Road?
Yeah, people were stealing it. That's why he said goodbye, Yellow Brick Road, because people were stealing it brick by brick, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Really sad.
Sad.
Yeah, that I didn't get any of it.
Of the Yellow Brick Road?
Melt it down and pay off all my debts.
Folks, still have one munchkin left, too.
Oh, do we?
Yes. Marin. What's his name? Marin. Still alive. He's like 97 years
old.
Wow. Oh, yeah. Yes, he's way up there. Jerry Marin. That's
okay.
Jerry Marin. Still with us.
Well, we have an episode of Bold Venture to bring you folks.
That's our show for today. That's right.
It's called Gun Running and the Poet Mario, also known as Deadly Merchandise. It's from Monday, April the 2nd, 1951, and it was heard in syndication. It stars Humphrey Bogart, Lauren Bacall, Jester Hairston, Jay Novello, and Tony Barrett. The sponsor varied due to syndication. Of course, different commercials, different markets. And Steve is sitting by with some information on Bold Venture.
Yes, John, Bold Venture. There have been other Hollywood power couples, but very few held as much sway as Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall. The first time the duo worked together was in Howard Hawks' film To Have and Have Not. Loosely based on the Hemingway's novel, it's the story of an American drifter living in the Caribbean, the kind of person that trouble often finds, who becomes involved in intrigue as well as with a sultry young woman who seems so wrong but ends up so right for him. Bogey and Bacall had a scandalous May-December romance that began during the film and blossomed into one of Hollywood's strongest marriages. Along with their movie projects, they came up with the radio treasure Bold Venture. It was a formula that had worked very well for other movie couples, like Ronald and Benita Coleman in The Halls of Ivy. The characters and situations of Bold Venture were similar to ones which had worked in Bogart films before, especially To Have and Have Not. Slade Shannon is an amalgam of bogey characters, owner of a small hotel in Alaric in Casablanca, and a charter boat operator in the Caribbean a la To Have and To Have Not, and Key Largo. Playing Sailor Duval on the radio, Lauren Bacall is just as sultry and alluring as she was on screen. The show's producer, Frederick Ziv, won a bidding war to get the show, and he entered into the collaboration with the big stars with gusto. He brought in such writing talents as Henry Hayward, who would later work on I Was a Communist for the FBI, as well as the famed writing team of David Friedkin and Mort Fine, who had been a part of the team on the great show Suspense, and who would later produce I Spy on TV. Famed composer David Rose was responsible for the music. He did the stripper, David Rose, yes. The title for Bold Adventure is derived from Slate Shannon's power boat, Bold Venture. The boat, as depicted in promotional copy from Frederick W. Ziv, appears to have been a recreational trawler or a small, fast, converted sport fisher of the day. In any case, it was very versatile, sturdy craft, as many of the scripts underscore week after week. Apart from the understandably attractive multitasking aspects of producing Bold Venture for a transcribed syndication, the Bogarts, reportedly making $5,000 for each transcription session, had planned from the outset to put all the proceeds into their son Stephen's trust fund. What a nice name, Stephen. Taping sessions for the Bold Venture had been suspended from March 1951 for the Bogarts' trip to film The African Queen, but the couple returned to the U.S. in September 1951 to, among other chores, resume taping sessions for the remainder of the production run of 78 programs. They'd reportedly tape 30 or so before they departed for Europe, and a reported 3 programs a week for 10 weeks. That left another approximate 4 months of taping sessions to complete the scheduled Bold Venture run, at least 3 programs a week for 16 weeks. In the end, it appeared that Lauren Bacall enjoyed the experience more than Bogey did. Frederick Ziv had originally contracted with the Bogarts to option as many as 4 seasons of Bold Venture, but given their far busier lives in the interim, the Bogarts opted out after 1.5 seasons. That's it.
That's it. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, sir.
Aha! Bold Venture.
Bum, bum, yep. And, okay, let's get this thing tuned in for the good people.
McGee Machine, can we have some Bold Venture, please? I know you can do it.
Kind of sound like the hermit from the hermit's cave. Turn your lights out. Turn them out. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember Bold Venture, Gun Running, and the Poet Mario, also known as Deadly Merchandise, from Monday, April 2nd, 1951, originally in syndication by Frederick Ziv and Company.
Starring Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall. Together in the sultry setting of tropical Havana and the mysterious islands of the Caribbean. Bold Venture.
Sailor, Havana, Cuba, where we started from, where we get off, out.
How long can you keep it up, Slade?
Come on, come on, off the boat.
I said, how long can you keep it up? You've been sore ever since we left Key West. So we didn't meet him, so we didn't pick up his cargo.
Look, Sailor, a guy named Scarn sends us a wire. He says, meet him in Key West, move his cargo. I didn't want to go, you wanted to go.
All right, and Mr. Scarn and whatever he wanted us to bring to Havana weren't there. But we had a boat ride to Key West and back, you and me. That's nothing, huh?
Come on, sailor, let's get off the boat. Here, I'll help you.
I don't need any help. What are you angry about? The money we didn't make?
No, it was time away from Havana. But I didn't have to be away from her.
You talk about Havana like it was a woman.
Do I?
How do you talk about me behind my back?
Walk ahead of me and I'll think of something.
There's your Havana, a cockfight.
Come on, let's take a look, sailor. How's your bloodlust today?
Oh, let's get out of here.
Consider it, sailor. Two birds with steel spurs slashing each other to pieces. Let's pause and cheer.
Come on.
Oh, let's watch for a while. People get to enjoy this sort of thing. Let's find out why.
I don't want to find out why. I'll see you back at Shannon's place.
All right. Okay, let's go.
You get a bang out of watching that?
Well, it gives me a chance to get bitter. Makes me an honest man.
Por favor, senor, senorita.
Huh?
The cockfight disgusts you, huh? Si.
Your tastes are too delicate, or perhaps...
What's this slate? A new way to catch the Yankee dollar?
Or perhaps the Yankee merchandise.
The lady asks you what this is, amigo. Who are you?
Permit me to tell you the story of my life. I am a poet.
I guess that's worth a dollar. Give him a dollar, Slate.
And what are we, patrons of the arts?
Permit me to refuse the money. Permit me to return to the matter of the Yankee merchandise you have brought from Key West.
Well, this is a man with a problem, Slate.
You are the people from the boat, the Bold Venture.
We're the people from the boat, the Bold Venture.
Now it rhymes. Nice going, sailor.
Then it is a simple matter. Since you are the people from the boat, it is simple. We will make arrangements for the removal of the merchandise.
Now look, Shelley,
my... Mario. My name, permit me. That is my name.
Mario, sure. I forgot, my memory's a little shaky.
Mine too.
Hers too. So we're having a tough time remembering what this is all about. Slower reading, huh?
Are you trying to be clever, mi amigo? Or perhaps you have pleasure in tweaking my patience? The merchandise, permit me, but the merchandise. It is a matter of life and death. When shall we remove it from your boat?
The poet only knows one poem, Slate.
Yeah. Wave him goodbye.
A fond farewell, Mary.
But it is a matter... You cannot. The merchandise, it can mean life, it can mean death. You cannot refuse about the merchandise! The merchandise!
If you want to be happy and lead a king's life, never make a pretty woman your wife. Therefore, from a logical point of view, marry a woman uglier than you. A pretty woman makes a husband look small, and then he very often falls his downfall. Therefore, from a logical point of view, marry a woman uglier than you. Ah, Lady Sailor, Mr. Slade, why you come back so soon to King Moses? Because you love me?
Why else, King Moses?
I tell why else. Because on trip to Key West, something sour must have turned more sour. Am I inevitably correct?
You are inevitably correct, King Moses.
You come back to make King Moses sloppy with happiness, Mr. Slate. Therefore, order me about.
Bring us something to eat, King.
Oh, an ecstasy, a joy, a frenzy, a kick.
Bring us something to eat.
Right now, Mr. Slate.
You really do love him, don't you, Slate?
Uh-huh. Like he was my own.
How long does it take for someone to be your own?
Ah, that depends. Ready with the food, King?
Ready. Yours, Mr. Slade. Yours, Lady Sailor. You talk, I smile inside myself. I get my guitar, I got song for you.
Sing it, King.
A lady approach who waits for Slade. A lady so handsome no one can hate. A lady who in hotel did register. A lady who bring joy, maybe despair.
Pardon me, Senor Shannon, but I think perhaps you were looking for me. For Bibi. No, Senor?
Well, I don't know you, but I think perhaps I was looking for you. For Bibi.
Slate.
I want to explain something to you about the hotel business, sailor. I am what is known as a mine host. That comes in two parts. Mine and host. Sit down, Bibi.
That's it. Still you have not answered my question, Senor Shannon. You look for me?
Well, I look for a lot of things. Why particularly for you?
Because you are the man who brought his boat into port only a little while ago.
Oh, the lady wants a boat ride. Why don't you try the nearest tunnel of love, Miss Bibi?
This is included in the price we must pay for the merchandise?
No, Bibi. I throw that in for free.
Now, wait a minute. You said merchandise, Bibi. Isn't that what you said?
Yes.
Bibi, the gentleman posed a question. Will you answer the gentleman's question?
You know very well what it is we want.
Sure, sure, but let's hear it from your own red lips.
Now I understand. It is a matter of more money, huh? Well, we expected it, and we despise you for it. But we will pay it. I have room 6A. I will wait for you there. But give me 10 minutes to arrange for more money. When I pay your price, there will be no more delay. Is it final? It is final.
See, 6A, she said.
That's what she said, Slate. That's just what she said.
You know, Sailor, I think I can handle this alone. Why don't you wait for me downstairs, huh?
Because I'm afraid of the dark. I cry in it.
That's what I thought.
Now you know. Slate, that noise. It's already happened to us once today.
Well, maybe the little lady's a bookie for game cock fights. Hey, let's go.
Slate, look, look, her face, her body.
Yeah, slashed to ribbons, slashed to death by a gamecock.
Slate, oh, Slate.
Now, how do you like Havana, Sailor?
Mr. Slate.
Mr. Slate is wearing out his office floor, King Moses. Tell me, I'll tell him.
The police have made a farewell to the front door, Lady Sailor. They are 5 minutes gone.
Thanks, I'll tell Mr. Slate.
You want anything I can do for the after the police occasion, Lady Sailor? You, Mr. Slate?
No, I'll call if we want anything.
My guitar and me in hammock outside. You open the window and whistle for King Moses. If you want something.
Slate. Slate. What are you trying to build? All right. I don't blame you, Slate. I know. It's hard to believe.
What's hard to believe? Beautiful woman killed by a fighting bird. A bird with steel spurs on it.
Now, Slate.
And at my hotel. Girl locked in a room in my hotel with a bird bred to slash for blood. I don't like cops in my place. Cops are for the tourist trade, not...
Is that all that bothers you? The fact that the police were here?
What's it to you what bothers me? I didn't ask for your questions. I didn't ask for you.
All right, Slate, all right.
Kind of a jerk am I, anyhow? A man tells me to take care of his daughter. So I take care of his daughter. You. What am I? Out of my mind? I don't need you hanging around here, Sailor. I don't need anything about you. I got along great before...
Before my father died? What do you want me to do, Slate? Leave?
Well...
Sit down, Slate. You're sweating.
It's a trick I know. It's hot, so I sweat.
You want me to fan you? I'll fan you. You like me to fan you, Slate? Like this?
Look at you. The way you're dressed. Jeans, the way your hair is. Man has to walk toward you to know you're a woman. Why don't you do something about your hair, Sailor?
What's the matter with it?
Other women with hair like that, they'd...
With hair like what? Like this? You can touch it, Slate. Touch it. Go ahead. Touch it.
Answer the door.
You answer it.
Yeah.
Let him meet me.
Hey, it's the poet.
Tell him to come in. He can wave the fan.
An explanation for the events of this afternoon are in order. See?
Hey, well, don't make it tough this time, Mario. What are you trying to tell us?
A tragedy. The killing of the girl Bibi was a tragedy.
Oh, what do you know about Bibi?
Bibi was the sister of my wife. She... Please, what time is it?
Hey, look, if you don't...
It's almost 2:30, Mario.
Gracias. Now, permit me. It is very wrong that Bibi is dead. A wrong that is part of an even greater wrong.
So help me.
What kind of wrong?
Like so. The merchandise you have brought. Those of us on an island you know, here in the Caribbean, those of us who wait for the guns.
Guns? So that's it. That's the merchandise. Guns.
Precisely. Perhaps there is a better way to purchase human dignity, but we do not know of it. We need those guns.
And you think we have the guns for your revolution?
Of course. Like so. You came with the boat. Oh, permit me, I will answer it. A compatriot I am expecting. He is to meet me here.
Mario! Slate! Help him! He's shot.
Yeah. shot dead. Like so.
A lady, she come to Shannon's place, a delicate figure and clothes of lace. Then the lady, she died in Shannon's place, a gamecock with spurs, he slash her face. A poet, he came to Mr. Slate, make big apology for being late. He explains his wants to Mr. Slate, but bullet in heart bring him poor to stay. Mr. Slate, he turned to Lady Sailor. He says, you know...
That's enough, gang.
Do I call the police again, Mr. Slate?
No. Two people die in my place, that makes it personal. I like that poet.
You're not always a real tough man, are you, Slate?
I said I like that poet.
And that girl, Beebe?
And that girl, Beebe. What about her?
Did you like her, too?
She had a problem. She came to me for help. She died.
My father said you'd be a man like that.
Why don't you get out of here, Sailor? Why don't you go back to the States? Look at the mess. I'm in it, you're in it. Why don't you leave, Sailor?
You don't know, do you?
Mr. Slate.
Yeah, what do you want, King?
Here are the dead gentleman's papers from his pocket.
Oh, let's have a look. Mario Pavana, 64 Avenado, Lorca.
We're going calling, huh, Slate?
And when a man like Mario dies, somebody's got to tell somebody because somebody might want to know.
I would. I'd want to know.
Well, let's go to Avenida Lorca, Sailor.
Yes? What is it you want, senor, senorita?
We come to...
Is it about Bibi? My sister Bibi? If you have come to tell me of her death, it has already been revealed to me.
Well, just a minute, senora.
I am called Celestine. Will it not be easier for you so?
Yeah, easier. If you're Bibi's sister, then the poet Mario... Mario...
He's my husband. Yes, a poet and a husband. I'm fortunate, am I not? You are friends of Mario's?
Yes, friends. Sailor, I can't do it. You tell her.
Thanks loads. Senora Celestine, your husband...
What? What is it of my husband? What is it?
He's dead. Okay, Sailor. How long can you take to tell a woman her husband's dead?
He said he was going to the waterfront to write me a verse. A little verse. Who are you? Are you of the police?
We're Mario's friends. We want to find his murderer.
It will not bring him back.
Mario was telling us something before he died. About a revolution. About guns.
Mario was to me a man who loved me. Who wrote little verses for me. Of this other Mario that you speak, I know nothing.
Who would?
Señor Etienne Parada, maybe? Señor Etienne spoke often with Mario, late into the night, while I slept. I would bring them food, and then leave them to talk among men.
Where would we find Señor Etienne?
He has a villa at 17 Avenida Cuarteles. I think there is nothing more for us to say to each other. Adios, friends of Mario.
Come right in, senor. Senorita.
Is your name Etienne?
No, senor. I am the butler.
Where's Etienne?
In the auditorium with the rest of the guests. There is a concert. This way. In here. I will leave you. Adios.
Hey, some concert.
That girl, the way she's dancing, Slade. She's wonderful.
Yeah, real authentic.
Am I being rude?
Yes, you are. Can't you see that girl's trying to express herself?
I'm your host.
My name is Etienne. This way, please.
Yeah, sure.
Celestine called. She told me to expect you.
Did she tell you about her husband?
About Mario? Yes. Did you two kill him?
How's your record, Etienne?
Not flawless, senor. In here, por favor, this room.
Pepe!
Hey, what is this? Who is this guy?
These are the ones, Pepe. The man and woman we have been waiting for. Now, senor, you will tell us. Why have you come to Etienne?
Because I don't like my hotel to be loused up with dead bodies. First a girl was killed and a poet. Would you know why?
Yes, I would know why.
Who are you, Etienne? Why should you know so much?
It does not embarrass me to say that I am a patriot. You see, Bibi and Mario were revolutionary. They were killed by our enemies.
This we know.
They were killed to prevent them from taking guns across the Caribbean to our islands. The guns, they thought, were on your boat. We shall proceed without Bibi and Mario.
The man is talking like he's got the guns anyhow, Slate.
See, we have them. They came on another boat, not yours.
Well, use them in good health. Let's go, sailor.
Wait, senor.
I knew it. Peek over your shoulder, Slate.
I just did. Question, what's the caliber of the gun Pepe has in his hand? A 32 or a 38?
Looks like a 32.
It's a 38. You will help us, then.
Help you do what?
We have the guns, you have a boat. It's necessary to have both to get the guns to my island. Besides, I prefer not to have you roaming the streets of Havana until we have disposed of the weapons.
Who wants to roam the streets?
Me, Daddy.
Por favor, senor, move quickly. There is a great need to hurry. You admire the view, senor, eh? This cliff that screams down into the sea, or perhaps senor is afraid of such height. But the view is magnificent, no?
The guns are nice, too.
You have exquisite taste, senor. In guns, in boats, and
In me?
Precisely, senorita.
See how wrong you can be, Slate? The man said that you had...
Get off it, Andy, Etienne. What do we play now?
Oh, no play, senor, I assure you. Hard work. Pepe is below in your boat waiting for the guns. You will see that he gets them. Then you will take us to our destination on your exquisite boat.
You mean I lug them all the way from this cliff down to the boat?
Not quite so hard, senor. You see, we are prepared. A cargo net, winch. You place the guns in the net, then lower them to Pepe. Quick, simple.
Like pie. It'll be like pie, won't it, Slate? I'll help.
No, senorita, no. You will simply stand there because you will inspire the senor to magnificent effort. You may begin, senor.
So what happens when we're through here?
You will be killed.
Ask a silly question.
No, but it's so easy for you. You have but to die. Me, I have to commit a murder.
My heart bleeds for you.
Thank you, senorita. That's enough, senor, for one load. Lower the winch.
Aquí, Juan! Aquí!
Sí, Celestine! Sir! Celestine!
We're glad you're happy, Celestine.
Yeah, we're glad. Thanks for saving our lives. It was messy, but thanks.
My heart is filled with kindness for you both.
We'll drink to your heart filled with kindness in Havana. Tell your boy to take that gun away and we'll go.
You were so kind to come and tell me of my husband's death. I want to do something gracious for you.
In Shannon's place. Do something gracious for us in Shannon's place.
I will not permit Juan to kill you. You will die as suicides.
I wouldn't have it any other way. Tell us about killing people, Celestine. Were you born that way or did it come on you all of a sudden?
They tried to make a revolution. You were foolish enough to stumble into it. It is a pity you stumbled into the wrong side.
You and Juan here are the right ones.
You are all alike. Poets, revolutionaries, adventurers. All with the intellect of trained fleas. Bibi Mario Etienne Pepe.
Oh, yes.
Pepe is dead also. Juan took care of it.
Bibi was your sister. And married.
They were fools. They are happier dead. Now walk. To the edge of the cliff. Walk.
You're happy now, sailor? You're real happy?
What?
You came to Havana. You got what you came for, huh? Excitement, romance, a tropic moon, people killed.
You've gone crazy. What are you talking about?
What you wanted, isn't it, sailor? That's why you came to me, because it was empty for a girl like you back there from wherever you came from. Real empty.
Why you...
Don't slap me, sailor. I'll break in, too.
No one! No, do not put your hands on him. Leave them alone. Just keep the gun in his back. They will kill each other.
Sailor, watch it.
You watch it. He's got a gun in your back.
Have a gun in my back.
One! Careful, one! Careful!
The gun.
Get it, sailor. Pick it up. Now you, Celestine.
You let me go. Let me
Don't
go.
Struggle, Celestine. Relax. Enjoy yourself. I'm a tender guy. Oh. I'm taking you back to Havana.
Fool! Take your hands off me. Let me go.
Celestine. Oh. I'm holding you real tight till the Havana police take you away from me.
You hold her that tight, she's not going to be in any condition for the police. So what about Juan?
You got a gun in your hand, haven't you, sailor?
Oh, sure. Sorry. I forgot for a moment.
Oh, get with it, sailor. Keep that gun pointed at Juan till we get back to Havana.
Then what?
Then Shannon's place. Better back there. I'll want you with me.
Do you like it, Slate?
Like what?
Dancing with me.
Oh, it's all right.
I'm wearing a dress now.
Yeah, I noticed.
And my hair. You like it this way? You like my hair this way, Slate?
Let's get out of here.
I like it here.
Come on, let's go.
Go ahead. I'll find somebody who likes to dance.
I said come on.
Why?
There's a breeze outside.
What's a breeze got to do with it?
I want to see what it does to your hair.
And so our two stars, Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall, have brought to a close our latest Bold Venture story. Special music was composed and conducted by David Rose.
Hi there, this is Bill Bragg, the man with a million friends, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with my good friends Big John and Steve.
Big John and Steve, and we are back with you. This is The Glowing Dial, and we are celebrating Father's Day, which we already did with our Lone Ranger episode. Now we're just picking stuff out of our grab bag for you to listen to. You just heard Bold Venture. That was Gun Running and the Poet Mario, also known as Deadly Merchandise. From Monday, April 2nd, 1951, in Frederick Ziv Syndication. Now we have two more shows to bring you from the grab bag, but first we have some more birthdays. And I think it's Steve's turn here.
Celebrity birthdays. This set begins June the 14th, 1908. John Scott Trotter, born in Charlotte, North Carolina. He was a conductor for the Kraft Music Hall and Philco Radio Time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Next, we move on to June the 15th, 1910, David Rose. Wait a minute, I just mentioned him in one of our write-ups here. David
Mr.
Rose.
Mr. Stripper, yes.
Born in London, England. He was a conductor for the Red Skelton Show, and he did his own David Rose show and Bold Venture. And yes, he wrote the number one Billboard hit, The Stripper. Also the theme from Little House on the Prairie. Did you know that?
The Stripper was the theme from Little House on the Prairie?
No. David Rose wrote both of those. Laura Ingalls.
Laura Ingalls Wilder.
That's what made her wilder.
Oh, jeez.
Oh, dear.
Dare I say, continue on, sir.
Yes. Then we have June the 16th of 1907 in Malden, Massachusetts, Jack Albertson, famed character actor.
Oh, yes.
He was in Milton Berle's show, Phil Harris, Alice Faye show, Cavalcade of America, best known as on TV as Ed in Chico and the Man, and I've been seeing his sister all over the place, Mabel Albertson.
That was his sister, okay.
Yes, she was on Bewitched and multiple appearances on God knows every other show in the 60s.
I think Jack did a couple of Twilight Zones, too. Very good ones.
Mm-hmm. She was in, what did I see over the weekend? I saw her in something. Can't think of which it was now. It's one of those shows on rerun channels. Antenna TV had something on with her in there. All right, June 17th, 1922, Jerry Fielding, born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He was a conductor of the Hardy Family, Jack Parr Show, You Bet Your Life, plus a lot of TV and film music. And we have June 18th, 1906, wrapping up this set with Kay Kaiser, band leader, MC, the old professor. He did the College of Musical Knowledge, and he had two fun films, You'll Find Out, and That's Right, You're Wrong.
Yeah, that's right. You're
Wrong.
You'll Find Out is the more fun of the two because it's a comedy horror film. It has Peter Lorre, it's got Boris Karloff, it's got Bela Lugosi. So you put those three in with Kay and the band and Ishka Bibble. Fun hijinks are happening along with some spooky seances and things like that.
In a funny movie? I don't know about that.
And you can get You'll Find Out in our Amazon.com bookstore, the Glowing Dial bookstore.
You've been shopping, haven't you?
Oh, yes. I have the film.
Ah.
And if you haven't seen it, Steve, that's another thing that when you're over for a visit after we're done with the Glowing Dial, maybe we'll sit back and put that one on. It's short enough where it doesn't take too much time. It's under 90 minutes.
I can remember that for a future visit, sure.
Yeah, definitely. All right, and that's the birthdays for now, right?
That's right, Ollie.
All right, thank you, Stanley. A little more birthdays coming up before our last program in this episode of the Glowing Dial. So right now, it's time for that next program, and that's going to be an episode of Columbia Presents Corwin. This one is called The Undecided Molecule. This was the third in a series of 8 shows that came in the middle of the Columbia Workshop. They just, for these 8 episodes, changed it to Columbia Presents Corwin, because Norman Corwin wrote them all. It's from Tuesday, July 17th, 1945, over CBS. And it stars Groucho Marx, Robert Benchley, Vincent Price, Norman Lloyd, Sylvia Sidney, and Keenan Wynn. The program is sustained, like all the Columbia Workshop and the CBS Radio Workshop. They were both sustained programs. Very experimental, too, I think, as Steve will tell us in the information he's got for us.
Norman Lloyd. There's a name I just mentioned earlier today, too, and the fact that he's still living, and he's over 100 years old. Norman Lloyd is still with us.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Not too many of the folks we mentioned here are, but because radio was a while ago. So, all right. Columbia Presents Corwin. Norman Corwin, often hailed as the poet laureate of radio, was one of those rare artists whose genius was recognized in his own time. Corwin began his career as a journalist and settled in as one of CBS's most important writers before World War II. During 1941, Corwin was given complete control of the Columbia Workshop for a period of 6 months. Marketed as 26 by Corwin, the project required Corwin to conceive, write, cast, rehearse, produce, and broadcast an original radio play every 7 days. Perhaps Corwin's biggest triumph of 1941 was We Hold These Truths, which had been written to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the Bill of Rights. Pearl Harbor was bombed a week before the broadcast was scheduled, inquiring whether it would be appropriate to continue with the project with war news filling the airwaves. FDR himself said, "Now more than ever." In 1942, the network sent Corwin to work with Edward R. Murrow, reporting on conditions in wartime London and an American in England. With war-related work beginning to wind down, CBS was ready to begin taking advantage of Corwin's artistic prowess again. Columbia Presents Corwin was intended as a showcase of the writer's producer's work during the 1944-1945 seasons. The effort was not meant to be as intense as 26 by Corwin. In fact, several of the episodes over the two seasons featured reused scripts. Both the reused scripts and the original episodes reflected the high standards of Corwin's writing. 26 by Corwin had opened with a whimsical play called A Radio Primer that poked fun at the self-importance of the radio industry. For Columbia Presents, Corwin opened with the series with a movie primer. One of the lessons in this primer was K is for kiss. Kisses are where movies have it all over radio. The program reflected Corwin's wide-ranging interest in social issues, along with the laughs. A series of three episodes explored world cities, Cromer, England, New York, and Tel Aviv, and how the war affected them. An artistic highlight of the show was an American trilogy featuring the works of Carl Sandburg, Thomas Wolfe, and Walt Whitman. The war was drawing to a close, and for Corwin, there were still serious thoughts to think. The episode, untitled, was a study of an average soldier who dies in battle for his country. Home for the Fourth explores the things that make America great and why our boys were continuing the fight. Corwin's most famous broadcast, On a Note of Triumph, was written and broadcast at this time, but was not part of the Columbia Presents. The show was a celebration of victory in Europe, but Corwin was well aware the job was not finished. 14 August was the VJ Day broadcast and took the form of a soliloquy by Orson Welles. Welles acknowledged that victory came because God and uranium were on our side. The original broadcast was only 15 minutes, but was later rebroadcast with Welles and Olivia de Havilland. Ooh, there's another name that's still alive. She's over 100 also. As the war ended, Corwin chose to close down the series and move on to other projects. Columbia Presents Corwin ran from March 7th, 1944, to August 21st, 1945, for a total of 30 broadcasts. Some of the actors who appeared were Raymond Massey, Burl Ives, Minerva Pius, Rolf Bell, Lon Clark, Jim Backus, Frank Lovejoy, Frederick March, Charles Lawton, Dane Clark, Elsa Lanchester, and Glenn Ford, as well as the actors in the episode we're featuring today.
Okay. That's a lot of info.
It is, but interesting.
Yes, yes.
Two famous people at 100 and during the same mentioning there. That was unusual. And
the Columbia Workshop and then later the CBS Radio Workshop, same thing, just a rebirth of the previous one. They had a lot of great experimental programs. In one, they just put a microphone. They said, and now the sounds of New York City. Put the mic out the window and let it run for a half an hour, hoping no strong language would be uttered. But you had traffic sounds and everything. Elliot Lewis, you'll remember this one, did the Triple Threat Man, producer, director, writer, actor. That's four things, not three. But he did one called Nightmare, if you remember that. And you remember what the, not kind of a twist ending, but an interesting ending. And it was all, we featured that earlier on in a earlier edition of The Glowing Dial, way back in our YUSA days, I think.
That goes back, yeah.
Oh, yeah, it does. And it's just, check it out in our archives. It's well worth it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Steve. Time to present this program to our listening audience.
McGee Machine, we present Columbia Presents Corwin. There it is. See?
There it is.
Never
yeah.
disappoints us. Always.
So as Steve said, sit back, close your eyes, and remember, Columbia Presents Corwin. This is The Undecided Molecule from Tuesday, July 17th, 1945, originally over CBS.
Program in time to attend a trial stranger than any since we first learned the knack of breathing. And that was a long time back. The poor folks listening to other stations will lose all this. But congratulations to you for being no such fool as to miss the undecided molecule.
Columbia presents Corwin. Tonight, in the third of a limited series of eight broadcasts for CBS, Norman Corwin brings you The Undecided Molecule, a rhymed fantasy concerning dangerous developments among the elements, as disclosed by Robert Benchley, Norman Lloyd, Groucho Marx, Vincent Price, Sylvia Sidney, Keenan Wynn, and the music of Carmen Dragon, conducted by Lud Gluskin. The Undecided Molecule.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear. The cosmic alarm, which means I fear some woeful harm is afoot or a wing in the universe. Some deplorable thing, some active curse, like a falling sky, or a new star cluster been banged up by a cluster buster. Sounds to me like a dried-up sea, or another ice age for a spell. Or maybe it's only a freezing hell. On the other hand, it might possibly be that Hitler is alive and well. But after all, there's no point guessing. If it rings again in a manner pressing, I'll answer the interstellar phone. I wish they'd leave a feller alone. Why, only last eon... Hello, hello. Yes, this is he. What? Who? What's that? Say that again? But where? But how? But why? But when? Individually and solely? Now, wait a minute. Take it slowly. It did. Oh, no. Oh, no. Not that. Holy jumping Jehoshaphat. I'll call a session right away. You bet. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, grunt. Oh, moon. Oh, damn it. We are faced with a calamity. I must be cool as liquid air. Hold on. Who's that? Who's pulling my hair? Why, it is I. What am I scary at? Nonsense. I'll phone the secretariat. Oh, dear, I am in such a tizzy. The obvious rhyme, the line is busy. I'll try again. There's no harm trying. Oh, I'm dying, Egypt. Dying. Hello. Say, this is the fifth VP in charge of physiochemistry. Now, listen here. An especially perky molecule has gone berserk. It has refused to be confined, incorporated, or assigned to anything. It simply sits with a calm expression, and it knits. Now, by all means, we must prevent such an utterly dangerous precedent. One holdout molecule, unpent, can cause the cosmos great ferment. We must arraign this beast and try it. The charge? Inciting particles to riot. Okay, arrange. I mean arraign. I mean all three. I mean the twain. No, never mind. Just get it booked. Or else the universe is cooked. Oh, me, oh, my. Goodbye, goodbye.
Hear ye, hear ye. The Court of Arbitrations and Adjudications of Physiochemical Relations, Department of the Interior of the Atom, Criminal Sitting, Division of Investigation, Charge, Countercharge, Accusation and Confession... is now in session. The court will rise and face the justice who will adjust this case. See that your concentration centers on his honor, the justice, just as he enters. Which he is doing even now. Everybody bow! Everybody bow!
To it. Contrary notwithstanding, you may sit. Blake, read the charge.
May it please the court at all to wit...
It pleases the court. Get on with it. Whose voice is whom?
The cosmos and all the spheres, systems, clusters, galaxies, orbits, planets, satellites... Mm. Together with all species of animals, vegetables, and minerals appertaining thereto, of all conditions of age, social standing, and sex, versus... the anonymous molecule hereinafter referred to as X.
Hmm. What's the charge against said molecule?
Unwilling to be named, rebelling when defined, declining to be blamed, objecting when assigned, protesting when selected, resisting an attack, refusing to be directed, and talking back.
Most serious, most dangerous, so strange, it's almost strangerous, insidious, precarious, a shade below nefarious. The possibilities in sight are frightful, meaning full of fright, and rueful, meaning full of rue, and gruesome, meaning rather grue.
Providing, Your Honor, the charges are true.
Oh, why, yes, they must be proven true.
Which is something we have yet to do.
Quite right, but who was asking you? Now, is the prosecutor here?
Present.
Well, then, appear. The trial's on. Try not to miss it. Step up and state your case and be explicit.
May it please the court, this case involves a very small matter. By this, I don't mean mere trivia or idle chatter, but a particle of matter best described as little.
Smaller than a jot?
Even smaller than a tittle.
Are you referring to molecule X?
Yes.
And why don't you say so?
I will, if I may so. The point, Your Honor, is that should X be acquitted here, catastrophe will follow, since it must then be admitted here that all control of elements has given away to anarchy, and every substance will perforce be jittery and panicky. Thus, when we wish a molecule to join up with some other, to make a cup or lemon drop for the Karamazov brothers, to be a fog or a catalog, or a lawn to be idyllic on, a beagle or a bagel, or a mountain made of silicon, they may refrain, they may desist, and if enough of them should do so, there'll never be another tenor singer like Caruso. No dog to bark, no lark to hark, no grand old man like Talleyrand. No bee will be, you'll see no sea, no ostrich band for Sallyrand.
It's staggering. It's awesome, the damage X could wreak. By simply playing possum, it makes me rather weak. Clerk, order me a pony of spirits of ammonia.
Now there you are. If X's rebellion is indulged, I think it only safe to say, and fair to be divulged, there'll never be another atom of the element ammonium. So take that home and play it on Your Honor's own euphonium.
Young man, I blasted you a disapproving snort and warn you. One more phrase like that. Contempt of court. Now, who is here for the defense?
I am, Your Honor.
Well, commence.
I will. I do so. Now you see, sir.
I see nothing of the sort. Who's paying you your fee, sir?
No one at all. The way it is with me, sir, I'm acting out of interest in civil liberty, sir.
What's liberty to do with it, if you will be so kind?
Just this. Where in the universal law books can you find it's criminal for anything to be of open mind?
The precedent is ample.
It is. Let's have a sample.
Blackstone on the elements. Case of bismuth versus molybdenum.
All drat the books. Our legal forebears doubtlessly all fibbed in them.
Hold on there, you. Why, you upstart. Is not the horse before the cart? Where would we be without tradition?
In some advanced improved position.
What? What? Young man, are you a red? Have you been to the crimson bread?
Neither to crimson nor to purple.
Well, no whipper-snapping twiple. Challenge me. What do you take me for?
A most distinguished expert on the law.
Very sensible thing you've said today. Where were we in this trial, by the way?
On the right of X to have an open mind. Now, surely justice is not yet so blind as to be unfavorably disposed.
God's openness of mind, my mind is closed.
Your Honor, this is scandal.
Now, see here, I can handle this. Let's not have no more of your bold to-do. A molecule must do what it is told to do. Now, that's decided. Suppose we break for lunch. I'm famished. Been a tiring day. I sure would like to crunch. A nice fresh salad bowl of crispy, tangy hashish.
Your Honor, I cannot refrain from calling you a fascist.
Contempt of court. Flake, find the counsel for defendant, please. He has the brass to charge the bench with having fascist tendencies. Ridiculous and ludicrous. Make it a heavy fine. How could I be a fascist? Why, I am so benign, I hardly ever beat my wife. My children bow before me. I'm much admired by rattlesnakes, and birds of prey adore me. I'm tender and I'm sensitive. An anti-insurrectionist. I wouldn't hurt a cobra. And I'm anti-vivisectionist.
I'm sure that's absolutely true, and that you're not the sort who would deny a prisoner his right to speak in court. Your might is mixed with mercy, and wisdom's interfused. So how about a word or two from X, who is accused?
Oh, very well. Since your appeal is to the better side of me, let no one say my conduct here is prejudiced or snide of me. We'll hear from X, but make it short. Where is the little dope?
Right here beneath this new electronic super microscope.
Swear him in.
Put your right hand on the atomic table and say as loud as you are able, I do solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and buzz was the muzzawala, buzzawala, hut, set, fluga, bugle, putt, scuttle, button, nothing but the truth. So help me, I. Now testify.
What's that squeaking?
My client, speaking.
Well, how do you expect me to understand?
There's an interpreter at hand.
Where? I don't see any.
Right at your elbow.
Oh, yes. How do you do?
I'm very well, Bo.
Bo, aren't you getting a bit familiar?
I suppose I am, but please think nil of it.
Can you understand what the molecule says?
Yes. That's my business, isn't it?
A fake character.
Like a film by Disney.
Disney's not involved in this.
Why isn't he?
I don't know. Where does all this lead?
Nowhere.
Then please proceed. To interpret X for the court of Lex. Lex is Latin for law, I guess, which shows I too enjoy access to more than one tongue. I'm a giant intellect. Now let's hear your client.
Proceed if you will, Mr. Molecule. Let your story fairly leap from you.
Well, come on. Come on, we're waiting now.
The court wants to hear a peep from you. X says as follows. I cannot bring myself to be just anything that's asked of me. I cannot chide my inner soul. I must confide I've set a goal. I've thought it through and cannot bear to be shampoo for oily hair. My spirit sings, my fiber spiels of nobler things and high ideals. I'll fairly bust my heart within if I am just an onion skin. I worry some. What's drearier than to become bacteria? When I've tried hard to obey, my conscience cried, but hold, but stay. A worm for bait? I have my pride. I vacillate. I can't decide. Though Hamlet had a hard time, why, he wasn't so sad as little I. You see my lot?
Yes.
It's not for me to be or not, but what to be.
Mm-hmm.
My plight inside is bona fide. I can't decide. I can't decide.
I've never been so touched or moved. I sniffle and I blubber. I thought my heart was made of steel, but it is made of rubber. Poor little thing, tormented so by dreams of the eugenic.
Oh, fiddlesticks, this molecule is but a schizophrenic. How is it that in all the time since matter first appeared, each separate iota has loyally adhered to universal law without a solitary beef?
Beef?
Until this pipsqueak came along. Now suddenly there's grief. The heavens shake and earthquakes quake and oceans heave and slither. And dogs and cats and acrobats are in a frightful dither. A timid snip has lost its grip and whines of its neurosis. If you condone this freak, you'll reek of moral halitosis. I strongly urge your honor, purge X to its smallest decimal, or else the infinite will bow before the infinitesimal.
You're right. What was I thinking of to pity Jan Schlemiel? I thought my heart was fairly soft, but it is made of steel. I shall not spoil this molecule by sparing it the rod, and so I sentence it to die before a firing squad. Perhaps a little torture face, like singeing at the stake, and drops of water on the head, and for variety's sake, a little twist of the garrot, a slice of guillotine, and X shall mark the spot where X was boiled in Vaseline.
I ask this sentence be appealed.
Impossible. Your client's fate is sealed.
Ah, no. The court's decision is far from ineluctable. I must remind you, my good sir, that matter's indestructible.
Gadzooks, it is. I had forgot. We can't destroy a particle. It seems we're in the power of this clever young upstarticle.
The case is lost. I must withdraw. If punishment's not capital and X cannot be executed, I don't give a rapital. We can't imprison it, and we'd be in a most infernal stew with cosmic checks and balances eternally askew.
Oh, dear, Vesemir, Vesemir. What will become of all of us? This little jake and his strange quirk will surely be the fall of us.
Your Honor!
You mean me?
May I have a conference with you at the bench?
Why, of course. May I suggest a means by which disaster be evaded? My client is no pig-head and may likely be persuaded to join some element or other. X is not a softy.
No.
It merely wishes to belong to something fairly lofty. Its point of view is forward. Its attitude is global. Its heart is set on being part of something good and noble.
How righteous.
So I suggest you demonstrate, and this will never hurt you, that being this or that or t'other has a point of virtue.
Well, how do you propose we do it?
I have a plan.
I was coming to it.
Invite a representative of each important kingdom.
You mean like
Like Dempsey for the ring or Artie Shaw for Swingdom?
No, but you're warm.
A lion for the jungle or an eagle for all Wingdom?
Keep on. Remember, three of them and one for every kingdom.
Oh, I know. Animal and mineral and, I forget the third.
The vegetable kingdom.
Why, yes, of course. Absurd. That's splendid. We could get them here and each could make a pitch. And X could then make up its mind to which it wished to hitch. I'll call a recess in this trial while we round up a trio. Meanwhile, some music.
Plank?
Yes, sir.
Can you sing solo mio?
No, but the court musicians would be very glad to play for you.
Where's the conductor?
I'm right here.
Is everything okay for you?
You bet. Shall I begin, Your Honor, with a prelude by Stravinsky or a toccata for the G-string by the famous brothers Minsky?
Have you anything around that Dmitri Shostakovich wrote?
Oh, yes. A Passacaglia, and I'm sure that you will love its note.
I've changed my mind. I'll have a slug of music by Lynn Murray. The one he calls Wer Klär der Nacht von Chicken Mitten Curry. Is that title correct?
Ja, I fear it is.
Okay, then. Play it.
Here it is.
One, two.
Spokesman for the vegetable kingdom will rise and address the court concerning the advantages to molecule X of joining this classification. With handy allusions to paleontology, plant psychology, stems and flowers, roots and fruits, and outstanding examples of horticulture and botany, if he's got me.
I doubt that X shall ever see an atom lovely as a tree. Why, nothing has got quite the charm of the most ordinary palm, with coffee beans and turpentine, and grapes which make imported wine. And as for molds and types of fungus, we have some noted ones among us. Penicillin is a spore, noble beyond metaphor. Life is earnest, life is sweet, for the common sugar beet. Cotton, spinach, hemp and hop, one could really never stop singing vegetary praise for years and months, and weeks and days.
Well, X says that trees are chopped for wood and that he sees no special good in being a beet which people eat. X says a palm, though fine in Maine, can come to harm in a hurricane. The grape's a curse, since drinking is evil, and cotton is worse for the boll weevil. X does not wish to look for trouble. It's not his dish, the vegetable.
For a molecule that's supposed to be meek, the choosy Mr. X has a lot of cheek. Step down, vegetable. Let mineral speak.
The spokesman for the mineral kingdom will address the court concerning the advantages to molecule X of joining this classification. With allusions to metallurgy, gypsum, filiform silver, motor cars, nicobars, pickle jars, and manganese. Please.
Now, the way that X can best ensure his choice of substance will endure is to stop his flopping about and settle down to being a respectable metal. Oh, fiddly-dee, fiddly-dum, yum-yum. Oh, boy, aluminum. If he likes the work of Byron, he can be the iron in irony.
That sounds to me like pure, unalloyed non sequitur.
If he wishes to be a worker, he can serve in a column of mercury. And if he'd rather be gay and giddysome, there's radium, uranium, iridium. Oh, tantalum, tungsten, talcum, tin, ipsy, pipsy, bittersen, gin, alto, saxon, copper, tax, rax, and rax, parax, parax, merrily, barely, chili by gin, triple eye, zinc, and kale.
Team. Oh, I beg. Are these football yells necessary?
Yes, sir. Very.
Well, what do they mean?
Well, amphibolsphine and pyroxene, being amygdaloidally idiochromatic, may create a stalactitic static, affecting the skeletal speed.
Mm-hmm.
On this, the experts are fully agreed.
Mm. Well, that clears it up very well indeed. Proceed.
If X wants glamour, need he be told of silver, platinum, and gold? And the safest job on any planet is to be a nice, strong rock of granite. If he likes good cooking, a dinner will boil very nicely over mineral oil. Does he cry to be a wagon hitched to a star, then apply to be a Hollywood motor car? Oh, I could pour mineral oil before you forever and a day, if it wouldn't bore you.
Well, X says, says he, that any jury'll find mercury somewhat mercurial. Iron gets rusty, bare rock's too nude, talc is too dusty, oil is crude. The automobile is not his bent. One elliptical wheel means an accident. Gold you can keep. He simply balks at lying deep beneath Fort Knox.
I've never heard such utterly rash, hypercritical balderdash. If I weren't so stately and dignified, I'd take that molecule outside and bop him right in his little beezer. Who does he think he is, little Caesar? Ah. Let the animal kingdom present its spokesman. Come on. Where is the gent?
Right here, but Your Honor...
All right, begin.
It's a her.
Never mind. Swear him in. Swear him in.
Very well.
The spokesman for the animal kingdom, etc. Species of bird, bee, dog, flea, hen, men. Does solemnly swear, etc. In the name of the llama, new, orc, yak, kangaroo, slippery Dan, Charlie Chan, the common man, and so forth, that he or she will please go forth and testify to the legal cause.
Thank you. I gladly take the floor.
Rather pretty, eh bien? Hello?
I could fascinate X with the mystery of our considerable natural history. I could tell him the fame of each colorful name.
Go on, I'm goose pimply and blistery.
I could tell of a bird named the Smew and another eclect, Urubu, of Tsikatai Do and of Tsingle Ro.
And a fish that is called in canoe?
Quite true.
And a monkey that's called Wanderoo?
Quite true.
Oh, I just love to listen to you.
I could tell of the Vinegaroon, the Squacco, the Guiduck, Baboon, the Antelope Bongo, the crow known as Drongo.
Will you join me for lunch one day soon?
For the record, may I ask whether these names are real or fictionary?
Don't interrupt. They're all in your dictionary.
Now, the Kapakai has a whistle.
Of course.
Distinct from the Ling and Dixissel. The Zabu and Zivet, and Terek of Tibet.
I cling to your words like a thistle.
I urge X to join the Toucan or some other nice animal clan, like the beautiful Cootie or charming Agouti.
But what of the species of man?
Oh, that's another subject entirely. I do not recommend that X get involved in the affairs of mankind.
Is that because you believe in the principle of matter over man's mind?
No, but being human would surely hex a sensitive molecule like X.
Just how do you mean, Queen?
Well, it's not so easy to be a common man. No matter how much you work and plan, it's still a neat trick to live the span commonly allotted to the common man. A wandering breeze will affect your pump. If not a measle, then a mump. You can pull a tendon, get roundly hissed, or have to depend on an analyst.
How true.
You can get ptomaine or be undersold. Then there's Franco-Spain.
Fui.
And the common cold. A review can stink. You can miss a guess or be told how to think by the yellow press.
Did I tell you I greatly admire your dress?
No. There's water on the knee and athlete's toes, the doctor's fee and the running nose, aching bursitises, rashes and rickets, colitis and worsitises, and parking tickets.
Not in this court.
You can get diabetes or caught in the rain.
Not in this court.
You can run out of Wheaties or into a train. You can get neurasthenia. A blizzard can chill you. Your wife can be mean you. A dentist drill you. A plaintiff can sue you. A bite give malaria. If no lover woo you, alas, miseraria.
Very legal embroilments. Just let me take care of you.
Thank you. A fascist will fight you. And then there is asthma. Vampires can bite you and whine on your plasma. You can be badly reared and flunk out in Latin or tangle your beard in spaghetti au gratin.
It's fattening.
You can get a flat tire, drop teeth in the drain, or suffer a dire escutcheon stain. You can drown in the Dnieper or suffer the bends. You can wind up a leper and lose all your friends.
It's hard to wind up a leper.
You can settle in Philly or step in a pail or feel willy-nilly and cease to inhale.
How morbid, depressing, in fact suicidal. By the way, have you ever an hour that's idle?
Your Honor, my client has something to say.
I could meet you, What's that about X again, eh?
He's ready, I said.
Well, let him go ahead.
X says as follows. I'm glad to know the awful truth. Man has such woe, forsooth, forsooth.
What philosophy.
Yet what he's done, proud hands can clap. He's beaten the Hun and will the Jap. He flies the air just like a smew and swims for fair like the Incanoo.
Yes, like the Incanoo.
He has a soul. He reads Descartes. Like me, his goal is a thing apart. He's learned to kill the harmful bug by serum, pill, and sulfur drug. He beats the band and goes to school to understand the molecule.
You're the rascals.
In face of odds, he makes his way.
gives birth to quads, builds TVA, displays his charms, plays blindfold chess, listens to Brahms and CBS.
CBS, of course.
The common guy both thinks and feels. Nothing's too high for his ideals. Though it cost him, sadly, to put down Jerk.
Please.
He's not done badly. Look at his works. For all his pains, we owe him thanks. And I do gladly join his ranks. The human flock has golden fleece, grace to its stock and lasting peace.
Oh, splendid. What a moving speech. I had thought X a worm, a leech. But now I see he's a regular fellow. He's twanged me so I quiver like jello. Oh, joy, oh, rapture, fields of clover.
Looks to me like trial's over.
Quite so. My dear X, forgive the digression, but I'm sure you'll be happy in your chosen profession. As for you, Miss Anima, you are great. It's slightly extra legal, but have you a date for later in the evening? Do you like to dance? Have you any marked tendency toward romance?
I have. But what about the wife you seldom beat and the children you have mentioned who grovel at your feet?
Oh, ho, ho! Mere rhetoric and figmentary frippery. The legal mind behaves this way. It's very smooth and slippery when arguing. I have no wife or any such a fixture.
In that case, I will marry you, as in a Class B picture. We'll create a happy ending, plus two children of each sex.
To be a part of one of them, shall we invite Friend X?
Magnificent idea, that. Is our future child agreed?
X says indeed, and asks you speed your visit to the Reverend so we can have a life to lead and bring this to a clever end.
Hooray, I thought you'd never end. Will the court musicians kindly advance to the mic and play a wedding dance? And then after that, please segue and sally into a sort of a kind of finale. 1, 2, 3.
You have been listening to The Undecided Molecule, a rhymed fantasy written and directed and produced by Norman Corwin for CBS as the third of eight programs in the series Columbia Presents Corwin. Carmen Dragon composed the music, Lud Gluskin conducted.
That gifted man, Robert Benchley, appeared as the interpreter for The Molecule. And you can see me soon in the Paramount picture, Duffy's Tavern.
It was Norman Lloyd who did that wonderful work as the highly competent official clerk.
Quiet. Oliver Wendell Groucho Marx appeared as the judge. And I'm going to be together with my brothers on the stage and screen again in a night in Casablanca. Some one of these nights. Good night.
Vincent Price as the prosecutor was convincing and smooth and even slick. And you can catch me soon in 20th Fox's Dragon Witch.
It was Sylvia Sidney who convinced the molecule that being a human being can be fun. And if you'd like to see more of me, I'm appearing in the new film entitled Blood on the Sun.
I, Keenan Wynn, in sound mind and body...
I object.
Performed as the counsel for the defense of Molecule. And to give you an idea how versatile I am, I was also the spokesman for the vegetable
week at this time, Columbia presents one of the most popular and often requested programs from last year's series, New York, A Tapestry for Radio, starring Orson Welles in the role of the narrator. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Hello, this is actor Dick Beals, the voice of Speedy Alka-Seltzer. You are listening to The Glowing Dial with your effervescent hosts, Big John and Steve.
Big John and Steve, and we are back. This is The Glowing Dial, in which we are celebrating Father's Day. And we just heard a grab bag show. It was Columbia Presents Corwin, The Undecided Molecule, from Tuesday, July 17th, 1945, on CBS originally. We have one more grab bag type program to bring you. No particular theme about it, just something we pulled out and thought you'd enjoy. But first, we have some birthdays. And the last batch for this particular episode, June 19th, 1908, Mildred Natwick from Baltimore, Maryland. She was an actress in starring Boris Karloff, Best Plays, in the Campbell Playhouse.
I remember her from Snoop Sister.
Exactly.
You remember that one too? Yeah.
I was just going to mention that.
Yeah. Snoop Sister. That was a cute series.
With Helen Hayes.
Yeah. They were a cute older couple.
That was part of the NBC mystery movie that started off with the guy with the flashlight and the...
Yeah.
You know, the synthesizer thing that always used to scare me as a kid.
Oh.
Somehow it sounded like it was alive or something. I can't really explain it. It was a weird sound, and it triggered something weird in me.
It
maybe.
Had McLeod on it. It had Columbo.
Heck Ramsey.
Night Gallery was part of that one.
Banachek.
Yes. They were all
McMillan and Wife, all those, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, moving on. June 20th, 1904, Matt Crowley from New Haven, Connecticut. He was an actor. He was Mark Trail on the series Mark Trail, and Buck Rogers on the series Buck Rogers. June 21st, 1911, Irving Fine from Brooklyn, New York. He was a producer of the Jack Benny program, probably my all-time favorite. June 22nd, 1916, Johnny Jacobs from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, announcer on Yours Truly, Johnny Dollar, Frontier Gentleman, Granby's Green Acres, and many game shows on TV.
Is he still with us?
I don't know.
Usually you have a death date thing. Is there a next to him, no?
Yes, there is a death date, unfortunately.
Okay.
June 23rd, 1908, Mary Livingston, otherwise known as Sadie Marks, Vancouver, Canada. She's comedian, wife of Jack Benny. Mary Livingston was her stage name.
I didn't know she was Canadian.
And she's a very talented lady. Mm. She had great comic delivery. She sang well. And later on, of course, she had Mike and Camera Fright, so she wasn't on the show as much. They used to tape her lines at home and feed them in as they were doing the Benny Show live. So that was kind of tricky, you know, reacting to somebody's pre-recorded lines.
Yeah.
But they were a masterful crew there on the Benny Show, and they did it, and people didn't really know it was happening. But she did appear on some TV episodes, you know, notably the one where she takes Jack to buy a new suit, and Jack falls asleep, and they keep putting him in the window as a mannequin and redressing him. Frank Nelson was in that one, too. Very, very funny show. June 24th, 1904, we end out our birthdays with another Benny favorite, Mr. Phil Harris from Linton, Indiana, band leader and singer with the Jack Benny program, the Phil Harris Alice Faye Show, and many, many hit records and films as well. And that's all we have for the celebrity birthdays this time around. Like I say, our buddy Ron Sales has got you covered. If you want more, just go to glowingdial.com, menu to the left, click on links, and Ron's is one of the website links that we have lined up there for you. And visit them all, and let them all know Big John and Steve from the Glowing Dial sent you on over there. And, you know, I have never met most of the people, Steve, that we talk about here. We come across them every now and again. Oh yeah, Larry Stevens. We interviewed Larry, and there was a lot of fun. Gordon Gould a few shows ago.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But you were telling me about meeting a favorite person, and sometimes that doesn't always go as well as planned. I told you about the dream I had of interviewing Mitch Miller and how pleasant he was. Well, you told me that your mom met a famous person, and he kind of burst her balloon as to what she expected him to be.
Yes, a person I would never have been able to meet because he was not around in my lifetime. My mom was from the Chicago area. She grew up in Chicago. And as a youngster, she attended school at the namesake of the school, Carl Sandburg.
Wow. And,
they gathered all the kids together in the gym or auditorium or wherever for an honor. It was, you know, something was being celebrated, like it was the school's 25th or something anniversary. And Carl Sandburg, the school's namesake, was there. And he talked to the students for a while. He read some of his poems, and he sang a particular song that really stuck into my mom. And from that point on, she was not impressed with him. She just thought he was a very strange, dirty old man.
Did she say what the song was?
Eating Goober Peas.
Sounds like a Phil Harris tune.
And he actually demonstrated how you eat goober peas. He took his knife, rolled it into some, like butter, I think it was, and he had the peas, and he was eating them off of a knife right into his mouth.
Oh, now I remember what prompted you to tell me that story. We were talking about the Three Stooges and hoi polloi, and went to the professor's trying to teach them manners to win a bet. Mm-hmm. And Larry's eating, he's just got his knife, and he's going, and he goes, "What are you eating?" And Larry says, "Beans." And yes. that prompted Steve to tell me that story.
Yes, and that turned my mom off to Carl Sandburg. As famous of a poet and stuff as that he was, why did he have to have that particular behavior? I don't know. And she was turned off by Carl Sandburg ever since, so she never cared for any of his writings that she had to read in school after that point. So that turned her off to him.
Well, I guess for you history students, there's a lesson now that the deification of celebrities or famous people, I've always been against that because they're human beings just like us. They have their faults just like us. They just happen to have been born with a specific talent, one that happens to pay a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
Something that we all dream of having, but most of us are dead-end jobs that we really don't like doing, but we just have to.
You know, they might be a famous person, but they also have human frailties, perhaps. I mentioned the passing of Chuck Berry. He liked pornography, so he wasn't perfect. He was a human, too.
Yeah, we got mistakes. The current controversy with Bill Cosby. It makes me, go back and if I listen to one of his old comedy bits, they're still as funny as they ever were.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe I shouldn't, I should take that other issue that's currently going on with him, all the court cases and everything, and the accusations, as a separate entity. Because it doesn't diminish the fact that he still has some very funny comedy routines. Mm-hmm.
In the 80s, I really liked Madonna's music, but I really didn't like her lifestyle. I had to learn early on to separate the person from their talent, because they're not necessarily the real person.
Outside of
that particular artistic genre might be completely different. They don't necessarily fit with that, because they're a human being just like you and I.
They just happen to be in a business that pays very, very well.
And brings them to the forefront. I mean, it really makes them famous. People recognize their name everywhere because of that. But it doesn't diminish their being a human being and, living their lives as they see fit and sometimes offending others.
Right. I mean, granted, we can't all be hosts of an old-time radio show of this stature. But don't edit that out. Anyway, we have one more show from the grab bag, Steve. That's going to be an episode of Dark Fantasy. It's called Pennsylvania Turnpike from Friday, March 20th, 1942, originating out of WKY Oklahoma City and also carried on NBC. And you've got some information you want to share with us there about Dark Fantasy.
It's a fantasy, but it's also dark. Dark Fantasy had more emphasis on horror rather than mystery, but the shows also covered some science fiction and murder mysteries. WKY, Oklahoma City, had been a highly respected and equally highly sophisticated radio operator for over 8 years by the time this series first aired, November 14, 1941, so it was no great leap for NBC to take the gamble in taking the series nationwide. NBC Red and its flagship station WEAF began airing Dark Fantasy on January 1st, 1942 in New York, simultaneously with the broadcasts airing out of WKY Oklahoma City. So they took care of the Western broadcast then. WKY's talented writer Scott Bishop was responsible for all of the scripts. Indeed, the scripts were so chilling that both WKY and NBC felt obliged to air the program well after the 1940s children had fallen soundly asleep. An article that appeared in the April 19, 1942 edition of the Capital Times, entitled Dark Fantasy Sees Light in Tea Room, offers more insight on the creation of the show. Dark Fantasy, radio's weirdest thriller series, heard late in the evenings over station WIBA, was born in a Chinese tea room late on the stormy night of November 3rd, 1941, while Scott Bishop, father of hundreds of mystery novels, stories, and radio scripts, sat drinking an iced spiced tea concoction of his own invention with radio production man John I. Prosser in a haunt known as Yung Si Fu's. The darkly psychological conversation centered around mystery tales with frequent references to Poe, De Quincey, Blake, Coleridge, and other masters of the craft. Bishop's mind kept turning on the subject after he went home, so he sat down and wrote a 30-minute script called The Man Who Came Back. The next day, Prosser and Bishop read the tale over in a cold light of morning, decided it was good, got a dramatic cast together, made a recording, and submitted it, still hot off the internal infernal griddle, to the NBC Red Network's program department. 11 days later, Dark Fantasy had its premiere. Wow, that's rather quick.
Mm-hmm.
Asked recently why he thinks this type of mystery thriller had particular appeal for radio, Bishop reasoned, granted that listeners enjoyed a good whodunit yarn where all the facts have sound reasoning for existing, I think there is more fascination in the dark fantasy type of tale where the horror comes from things unusual or even supernatural. In this case, it is not the terror itself that causes listeners' hair to rise. It's the unseen, unaccountable cause of the terror.
Okay. In a lot of that latter part where it was from a vintage interview with Scott Bishop back in the day. But anyway, yeah, a little bit more about Dark Fantasy than maybe you knew before. And you know, there, another show I wish we could secure permission to play would be Nightfall, which was a CBC effort in the early 80s. And those were done in glorious stereo. And they went to town with some of their sound effects, let me tell you. I know they've been repeated on NPR in recent years. Not terribly recent, but maybe in some moment and sometime maybe those will fall into public domain and we can air them. But it's hard to find them in the original stereo, though. But another good show. And that was, I guess we'd call that new time radio, like CBS Mystery Theater and Mutual Radio Theater, shows like that, that tried to revive
still,
the art form.
Still original radio, but not in the radio time period up to, what, 1963, I think is as far as
62.
62, okay.
About the time I was born, dramatic radio was ending on CBS.
Yeah, everything was going television at that time. Everybody was getting TV sets, and radio was going, you know, away for the most part for original broadcasts and such, other than news and music.
Right, but that's the reason our show exists, because radio is valid as an art form then as it is now. It's the theater of the imagination, and I have special pictures in my mind that some shows have provided for me that nobody else may picture it exactly the same way. So it's just kind of unique to the individual.
Mm-hmm.
And I discovered that when I was about 12 years old with War of the Worlds, and it snowballed after that. So anyway, time to present Dark Fantasy to you folks. Steve, take your place at the McGee Machine if you would.
Hi, McGee Machine. Hey, we need some Dark Fantasy here today. Can you bring that to us, please? I think it's doing it.
Yep, there we are. Yeah. All right, folks, sit back, close your eyes, turn off the lights, turn them off, and listen to Pennsylvania Turnpike. From Friday, March 20th, 1942, originally over WKY Oklahoma City and NBC.
Howdy, stranger.
Howdy, mister. Mind if I come in and sit a while?
Nope, reckon I don't. Gets sort of dad blame lonesome along this highway.
Much obliged. My feet wouldn't hold up another mile.
Are you hitching?
Yep.
Going fur?
Don't know.
Did you come fur?
Yep. Come a ranch, smart piece.
Getting pretty old, be hitchhiking. Get many rides?
Yep.
Had anything to eat lately?
Not much. Coffee smells good.
It is good. Make it myself. How about a cup? Warm you up.
All right.
Matter of fact, I'll have one with you.
Got any manse bread?
Any what?
Manse bread.
Never heard of it.
No. I forgot. Reckon you never have.
Here you are, mister. Nice and hot.
How much?
Oh, just a nickel.
I don't know what a nickel is, but take it out of that.
Much obliged. Hey, hold on. This ain't no nickel.
What's that, mister?
I say this ain't no nickel. It's a gold coin. Hey, don't you know it's against the law to have gold in your possession these days?
Against what law?
Why, well, we went off the gold standard years ago. Everybody turned in their gold. Well, they turned into the government. And they got silver in exchange.
I see. And you best return my coin.
Well, this coin is old. Ain't it, stranger?
Somewhat.
Yeah, old. Got the head of the King of England on it. Can't see the date very well. Let's see. 1700
and
something.
Take this coin instead. Gave you the gold run by mistake.
Well, brother, I ain't making no mistake when I give it back to you. To my way of thinking right now, that gold coin ain't worth a plug nickel.
Yeah. I think you'll find this one's legal tender.
Yeah, thanks. How about a sandwich?
A what?
A sandwich.
I don't know what you're talking about.
You're a queer one. Here. Wrapped up in this wax paper. A sandwich.
Never seen nothing like that before.
Yeah? Why don't you try one on the house?
Eh?
I said try one. No charge, yours.
Oh. Thanks. Good coffee.
Yeah, got to admit it is. Folks around here always have a good word to say for Joe Davis and his coffee. Don't you know where you're heading for, stranger?
No. Haven't the slightest idea.
How come? You mean you're just roaming about with no particular end in mind?
No. I've planned what I intend to do for years.
Well, what are you intending to do?
That I'll discuss with no one.
Okay. Don't get the idea I'm nosing into your business. How's the sandwich?
What's that?
I said, how's the sandwich?
Oh, this. Not so good. Tastes funny.
Oh, that's good boiled ham.
Don't like it.
Well, you got no kick coming. Didn't have to pay for it.
I intend to pay you.
Nope. No charge.
But I always pay all my debts.
Well, this is one you don't have to, stranger. Especially since you don't like the thing.
I've paid every debt I ever owed. Except one.
Well, one's not so bad. You'll probably get it paid off someday.
Yeah, I'll pay it. I waited long enough. I can wait a while longer.
Want more coffee, stranger?
No, this is plenty. By the way, do you happen to know many people in these parts?
Quite a few, yes.
Ever run on to any folks with red hair?
Red hair?
Yeah.
Well, let me think. No. No, can't say the hell. Why?
Oh, I'm just interested in folks with red hair.
Are you?
Only take rides in cars with men with red hair.
Why is that?
Oh, I got a pretty good reason. You see, the man I owe that debt to has red hair.
Oh, has he?
Brilliant red.
Where are you putting up for the night?
Sure. Depends.
Well, there's a tourist cabin about 2 miles up the turnpike.
Might stop in there. Place have many customers?
Yep, quite a few along this time of year.
Might stop there then, have a look around.
Mister, if you don't mind my saying so, you've got me puzzled.
And so?
Yeah, you sure have. Those clothes you're wearing. Never seen anything like them before in my life.
You probably never will again.
What do you mean by that?
Oh, nothing especially.
You're sure the mysterious one. You better have another cup of coffee.
No, thanks.
Well, how about a cigarette then, huh?
No, I'm old-fashioned. I smoke a pipe.
Well, okay. Fill up then. Say, what kind of tobacco is that?
Oh, it's King's Choice.
Never heard of it.
No. Reckon you never have.
Something new?
Older than you were.
Where can you buy it?
Reckon you can't anymore.
Oh, quit making it, huh?
About 100 years or so back. You wouldn't remember.
Oh, you're ribbing me, huh? Of course I wouldn't remember 100 years back. Neither would you.
You'd be surprised, mister.
What do you mean?
Nothing, especially.
I don't get it. Look, you smoking tobacco 100 years old.
Nothing particularly remarkable about that, is there? I always say what's old belongs to the old.
But I reckon you're not more than 60.
60?
Sure, 65 at the most.
My friend, suppose you take 60, double it, and add a century.
What? Double 60 and add 100? Why, that's 220.
Your arithmetic is excellent. Have a match?
Match? Match? Oh, yes. Yes, sure, match. Here you be.
Thank you. You have a customer.
Oh, yes. Generally, somebody stops for a few gallons of gas along about this time.
Better throw away that cigarette around that gasoline.
Be back a minute, old-timer. Yes, sir. A little gas?
No, I'd like a little information.
Well, got a lot of that, too.
Can you tell me the way to Pine Knob?
Pine Knob? What's that, tourist camp?
No, it's a town. Pine Knob, Pennsylvania.
Never heard of it.
It's out this way someplace. It's supposed to be about 80 miles out of Pittsburgh in this direction.
Well, see, Pittsburgh's about 78 miles back.
Well, then I should be pretty close.
Never heard tell of no Pine Knob. Been living here, man and boy, for 40 years. Ain't never seen nothing of the place or heard tell of it.
Well, I know it's out here someplace. I followed my directions here. I don't know whether to take that crossroad or follow the turnpike.
Sorry, can't tell you, mister.
Perhaps I can.
Eh? Oh, you.
Pine Knob, you say, mister?
Yes. It's a small town somewhere in this neighborhood.
Not in this neighborhood, it ain't.
You don't happen to remember anything about it, do you, old-timer?
That's a nice hat you're wearing.
Huh?
I said that's a nice hat you're wearing.
Yeah, thanks. Did you ever hear of Pine Knob?
Mind if I see it?
See what?
Your hat.
Oh, forget my hat. You know anything about Pine Knob?
I might. After I've seen the hat.
Look here, if you know how I can get to Pine Knob, I'll...
Hey, look, mister. Let him have a gander at the hat. You were the old boy. He hasn't got all his marbles.
Oh, very well. Here, you can buy it in any hat shop for $10. Free initials if you want them.
Yeah. Quite nice.
What's that? The hat? You haven't even looked at it.
No. I was admiring the gentleman's hair.
What about my hair?
I said it's nice. Right.
Now, how about the hat back and a little information?
Oh, your initials in the band. KM. Could the last name be Minor?
Yeah, that's right. Oh, you saw my driver's license on the steering post.
No.
How'd you know?
I just hoped I was right.
Oh, hang it all. Do you or don't you know how I can get to Pine Knob?
Yes, I know.
Will you tell me then?
No, I can't do that.
Why not?
Because the way is seldom traveled. You'd never find it by directions.
Then can you go there with me to show me the way?
There's nothing I'd like better than to take you to Pine Knob.
Well, now, that's more like it. I'll pay you for whatever your time's worth.
I'll collect, all right. But I assure you my time's of practically no value whatsoever.
Come on around, get in.
I'll ride in the back.
No, come on in front with me.
No, thank you. I prefer the back.
Say, mister, you better humor the old boy as much as you can. He ain't as bright as he probably used to be.
Oh, all right. All right, old-timer, hop in. Thanks a lot.
Oh, you're welcome. Come back and see me.
Well, I see him come and I see him go. But that old gent beats anything I've ever set eyes on. Oh, the old man dropped his bag of tobacco. Almost half full. King's Choice, the smoker's friend. Raymond Tobacco Company, established 1756.
Turnpike in a minute or two.
Then how far?
Not fur.
The road good?
Not so good.
I say, does my chatter bore you, old-timer?
Not especially.
You give me the impression you don't want to talk.
People talk too much nowadays.
Me, I like to talk. Especially when I'm driving. Helps make the miles go faster.
The turn up ahead.
Yeah, where?
Off to the right.
There's no place to turn off.
Yes, there is. You see it. There. See?
Well, yes. Well, that road, it wasn't there a moment ago.
It's been there for years. It's the road to take.
This isn't any ordinary road.
Right. It isn't.
And no automobile tracks.
Never been an automobile on this road.
I don't understand.
You will. Presently. And a stagecoach.
Stagecoach?
Yes. You can see the hoof marks in the soft earth.
Oh, I was noticing.
Six coal black horses, the pride of Pennsylvania.
What's that?
Nothing important.
I see. Look behind.
Behind?
Yes. Look, where's the turnpike?
We have left it. Far behind.
Oh, not far. Less than a half a mile. We should be able to see it from here.
No. Nowhere in view.
The buildings along the turnpike, where are they?
All of that is past.
Past?
Yes. There is no turnpike. There are no buildings.
Nothing but open prairie land. Trees. Hills. Tall grass. No fences. No other roads except this one.
It's the only road for miles around.
Where does it take us?
To Pine Knob. That's where you wanted to go?
Well, yes, but I...
You asked me to show you the way to Pine Knob. This is it.
Well, everything's changed so. Suddenly, everything's different.
Yes, naturally.
But why?
Did you ever ask yourself what time really is?
Time?
Yes, Mr. Miner. Time.
I don't follow you.
Suppose a long time ago, something had happened to you. Suppose that incident was so important, so outstanding in your life, it was necessary for you to do something about it.
I still don't understand.
Let me put it into the present instead of the past. Suppose today something should happen to you. Suppose it is so out of the ordinary that you'd never forget it. Probably something you think needs revenge.
Revenge?
And suppose you decided your spirit would never rest until you'd found that revenge, even though many scores of years had passed away.
I don't understand.
Now, what would you do, Mr. Miner? What could you do but roam from place to place seeking that revenge?
You're talking over my head.
Am I?
You certainly are.
What I'm getting at is this. If you'd find yourself in just such a situation, time would suddenly have no meaning to you. You'd think no more about the past, or the present, or the future. Time would be something unknown to you. Things you call the future now wouldn't be future at all. Incidents you called past wouldn't be past. They'd be now. What you call present, all rolled up into one.
Yeah, that's a strange way of reasoning.
Not so strange once you've experienced it.
Have you ever experienced it?
I assure you, yes.
You mean that things that have happened in the past are actually happening now?
Precisely.
And things in the future are taking place now, too?
Naturally. One case being possible, the other naturally follows.
Why, just some philosopher's theory.
It's much more than a mere theory.
Oh, you know better than that, and so do I. What's happened in the past has happened. What's going to happen certainly isn't taking place now.
Possibly I'll change your mind about that before this day ends.
Oh, no. Not me, mister. By the way, you haven't told me your name.
Names are unimportant. Only incidents are important.
Yeah. You haven't said how you knew my name.
That was quite obvious. Your red hair. The initials in your hat band.
I still don't see how you
There's
knew.
There's Pine Knob. Ahead.
Yeah. Down in the valley.
Yeah.
Where did it get its name, Pine Knob?
Because in the center of the town you'll find a little mound. Three pine trees growing from it. It was under these trees that men have been trying for their lives. It's from them that men have been hanged.
Hmm. That's a pleasant thought. The town seems deserted.
Yes, I suppose it is by now.
What do you mean?
You'll see. There. Stage office is over there. The stage is in. See? Across the road. Pull up here. Across from it.
Yeah, right. So this is Pine Knob. I see. That man on the stagecoach with the reins in his hands. And that other man handing up that metal box.
Quiet. Listen to what they say.
All right, Hank. That's a goal. Better take good care of it.
Ain't nobody gonna get this gold. It's going right on through to Kelby. If anybody tries to stop the stage this trip, I'll be ready for them. Pass along, partner. See you in a week. Come on, boy. Get up there. Gee, get up.
Those two men. The one on the stagecoach.
Exactly.
He looks and talks exactly like you, and the other one like me.
We must follow that stage. Start the car.
I don't understand all this.
Start the car. Follow the stage.
I'd take my oath that those two men are exactly...
It's not time to talk. Follow the stage.
Oh, what is this, a dream?
No. I waited a long time for this day.
What do you mean?
Yes. And 9 score years I've waited.
9 score?
More than 3 normal lifetimes, and finally the day is here.
Look here. Whoever you are, would you mind telling me just what this is all about? Why are we following that stagecoach?
See? It's beginning.
What's beginning?
Stage. See? It stopped.
Yeah. Something's wrong.
More than you think. Drive right up behind it.
Maybe we can help.
No, there's nothing we can do. Stop right behind the stage.
Yeah. Hey, look. Look at that man standing at the side of the stagecoach, talking to the driver.
I'm watching him.
He's the man with the red hair. The man who looks exactly like me. And the other one on the stage, he's the exact image of you.
Quiet. Watch what happens. Listen.
What's up, partner? Called me out of town, did you?
Yeah. I sure did, Hank. I reckon I'd better take that gold.
Take the gold? Where?
Just take it. Hand it down, Hank.
Hold on.
Questions? Just hand down the box.
I don't think I'd better, Ken.
Now look, I mean business.
You drawing a gun on me, partner?
I mean business, Hank. Hand down that gold.
You're robbing this gold.
I'm taking it and clearing out. Here tell folks is settling out west. I aim to go there.
Ken, I done trusted you like a brother. I never thought the day'd come when you...
Hand me down the gold, Hank.
This gold is going to kill me.
It ain't going no farther than it is right now. I'm taking it with me.
Put away your gun, Ken.
Don't argue with me, Hank. I'll shoot you if I have to.
And by Jimmy, you'll have to. I ain't handing down this gold.
Keep those hands on the reins.
Not on your life, partner.
Don't go for that gun.
I didn't shoot you.
Wasn't going for no gun. You've murdered me.
No. For heaven's sakes, this isn't real. I've never fired a gun in my life.
You think it isn't real?
No. Well, it can't be.
Now, you understand what I meant by no past, no future?
Man on the stage, you.
180 years ago on this spot.
But it can't be you. That man on the stage was shot. He fell. He's lying there on the ground now.
Yes, hey, turn around. See for yourself.
Gone. Everything's gone.
Everything but you and me.
I didn't kill you.
That man with the red hair. The one who spoke like you, looked like you, was the first member of your family to settle in this country. He was my partner. I trusted him. He murdered me.
But I didn't.
Now, the debt is about to be paid.
No. No, you can't blame me for something that happened almost 200 years ago.
I've waited this long for my revenge. I won't let it pass by now. Get into the car.
No. No, keep away. Don't come near me. Don't touch that wheel.
Time has come. I'm driving now.
No, no, I say.
There's no way to escape.
You can't murder me. I had nothing to do with that shooting.
You can't escape.
I will escape. I will.
You're doomed.
I knew you were some devil. You brought me here to kill me. But you can't. You can't.
The road ends around the turn up there. Nothing but a 1,000-foot drop down the mountainside.
Fantasy.
Pennsylvania Turnpike. Tonight's original tale of dark fantasy by Scott Bishop, originating in the studios of WKY. Ben Morris played Ken Miner, Fred Wayne was heard as Hank, and Muir Height was the filling station attendant. Next Friday night at this same time, listen to the 19th in this series of unusual and original tales of dark fantasy, created by Scott Bishop. Next week's story is called Convoy for Atlantis, a fantastic yarn of ships that disappear in the night, and of strange and valuable treasures which arise from the sea. An adventure that takes us down to the very bottom of the mighty Atlantic Ocean for a special observation of the Convoy for Atlantis. Don't miss this weird tale of an ancient race that lives again on a mighty sunken continent. Tom Paxton speaking. Dark Fantasy comes to you from Oklahoma City. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Good ladles, evening and gentlemen. This is Jay Ronburn inviting you to hear the Gliling Dole. I mean the Dueling Glile. It's the best in old raid timey-o with Big Ston and Jeeve. Don't dutch that tile.
Big John and Steve back with you one final time in this episode. You're listening to The Glowing Dial, in which we celebrated Father's Day and dug some great shows out of our old-time radio grab bag. We just heard an episode of Dark Fantasy that was called Pennsylvania Turnpike from Friday, March 20th, 1942, originally from WKY Oklahoma City and carried by NBC across the country. Steven.
Yeah.
We have come to the end of another show.
Oh, we have, yes. It's
yes.
Been fun, John. It really has.
And these chairs have, like I said, really been growing to our posteriors, and it's going to be good, albeit a little painful, to stand up. But before we go, before Paul Whiteman materializes with our closing theme, I want to tell you what's coming up on the Glowing Dial in coming weeks. On June 25th, 2017, we are going to celebrate Independence Day, and we have two shows, Mr. President and Ripley's Believe It or Not, in that vein, and we're going to do some grab bag shows. We got an episode of Dream Time, which is also known as The Bickersons, not just the sketches, it was the full half-hour show, and we have an episode of Escape. Coming up on July 16th of 2017, we are afraid of something in the night. We have four shows with either night in the title or in the episode. We have Night Watch, Night Beat, Inner Sanctum Mysteries, and Creeps by Night. That's all coming up on July 16th of 2017. And lastly, on August 6th, 2017, me and Steve are going to be celebrating our friend Stu's birthday with a show that was an episode of The Shadow that was broadcast on Stu's birthday back in 1938. And then we got some more grab bag shows, an episode of Hallmark Playhouse, Hogan's Daughter, and Mail Call, which is a real fun Armed Forces radio show. That's all coming up starting August the 6th of 2017. So stay tuned for all of that goodness. And I think, looking behind me here, Steve, thank you once again for joining us.
My pleasure, John.
He just made an okay sign for those of you listening at home. Paul Whiteman, I think, is materializing. There he is. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, guys. Before we get on out of here, we have those reminders. Remember all the great places you can hear the Glowing Dial tri-weekly podcast. The Glowing Dial page, Jerry Hanniger's Old Time Radio Network, iTunes, Google Play Music, YouTube, and the Internet Archive. How many more could there possibly be? Glowing Dial Online Store, we'd like you to check that out. Plenty of great gift ideas with the Glowing Dial logos. We hope to design more in the near future. It all depends on our artist friends and if we can get them to work for free. Glowing Dial Online Bookstore through our association with Amazon.com is something we want you to try out. and do all your Amazon shopping by clicking through our store. We'd really appreciate it, and you would help support The Glowing Dial. Remember to join our blog and our Facebook page and get all the latest Glowing Dial news and information. You can do that by just going to our main page at glowingdial.com. Celebrity birthdays, well, like we've already told you, our buddy Ron Sales has got that covered. He has them for the entire year, so you can see who you share your birthday with. And you can view his blog by going to glowingdial.com once again. The menu to the left is click on links, and Ron's page is one of several you will see there, and we recommend them all. Drop Ron an email and let him know what a great job he's doing. Tell him Big John and Steve from the Glowing Dial sent you on over there. We want to give a great big thank you to our friend Jerry Handigas, not only a friend of the Glowing Dial, but a friend of Steve and myself. He has an audio restoration service we want you to know about. He can transfer and clean up those old recordings for you, get rid of all the clicks and the pops and transcription discs and maybe even, 78s, definitely audio tapes. Contact Jerry for his details on that. And you can get to him by our glowingdial.com. Click on links, and Jerry's audio restoration services is there, too. Jerry also has his old-time radio network, where you can hear Jerry's own show, our show, and several others on demand in streaming audio. Don't forget to thank our main sources of information in the shows that we bring you. Good friend John Dunning, author of On the Radio, the Encyclopedia of Old-Time Radio, On the Air. I got that title wrong, but you know what I'm talking about. John, over at OTRCat.com, great place to get MP3 shows. Good folks over at Digital Deli 2. And the Glowing Dial page. So until next time, Big John and Steve saying, see you on the radio.